the Father told us to, yeah. Put them on a jet light. We're the ones in the spotlight. Be like, damn right. You just say you don't want it with the sunlight. Real Jews in the cut light. Blacker than the Klondike. Who that is, that's us. Gonna be here like every night. We gon' rule the world. We gon' rule the world. Gonna be here like every night. We gon' rule the world. We gon' rule the world.
Gonna be. I remember reading that the truth will set you free. And if the sun shall make you free, then you are free indeed. I seen a lot of oaks, heard a lot of lies. But when I read the word, there's no compromise. So I'ma be honest, I'ma be honest, I'ma be honest with you, yeah. I'ma be honest, I'ma be honest with you, yeah. I seen a lot of oaks, heard a lot of lies. But I'ma be honest, I'ma be.
My life, I did wrong to you. And I'm sorry for
sorry,
the things
sorry
I called you do. And I feel I don't deserve this. I just don't deserve this. I just don't deserve. And I feel I don't deserve this. I just don't deserve this. I just don't deserve. For me, and I did you wrong, but you still care for me.
I know you do.
Locked up in my own ways, but you came and set me free.
Yeah, you set me free. Yeah, you set me free.
And by your side. To you. And I'm sorry for
sorry,
the things I called you do. And I feel I don't deserve this. I just don't deserve this. I just don't deserve. And I feel I don't deserve this. I just don't deserve this. I just don't deserve.
Change my mind. You made me fall in line. Chose me, but I don't know why.
I don't know why.
And I feel good. I can never lie. And I just wanna say thank you for all the things that you've done for me. Gotta prove to you how much I love you. When you rain in your blessings, remember me. And I just wanna say thank you for all the things that you've done for me. Gotta prove to you how much I love you.
Because to serve you is my destiny. All my life,
yeah, all my life,
I did wrong to you.
Oh, I did you wrong.
Yeah, I know I did you wrong. And I'm sorry for
sorry,
the things I told you do. And I feel I don't deserve this. I just don't deserve this. I just don't deserve. And I feel I don't deserve this. I just don't deserve this. I just don't deserve.
Sorry for. Sorry for.
And I feel I don't deserve this.
No, no,
I just don't deserve
no,
this.
No,
I just
no.
don't deserve. And I
Bishop on deck. Let's go, y'all can go harder now. Let's go. Bishop on deck. Clap your hand, clap your hand, clap your hand, clap your hand, clap your hand. Hand. Salute. Salute. Down. Face Jerusalem. Men of Israel, blow trumpets. Trumpets down.
Heavenly Father, we come before thee in thy son's name, Father, thanking you, Father, for all things. Heavenly Father, we come before you, Father, asking you, Father, that you bless us, Father, with knowledge, wisdom, and understanding, Father, that you let your words come out of Bishop's mouth today for class, Father, that it edifies the nation, Father. Father, in thy son's name, we come before you, humbly asking you, Father, that you heal our brother Alicia, Father, who's in the hospital, Father. Heal him of his sickness, Father. Heal all those, Father, who maybe have ailments, Father, who may be going through things, Father, who are down, Father. We ask you, Father, quickly and speedily, Father, send thy mighty angels, Father, to encamp around them and protect them, Father. Father, in thy son's name, we ask you, Father, that you deliver us from our captivity, Father. All the nations, Father, that have come against thee, Father, we ask you, Father, that you rise up, take down all nations, Father, that have come against thy people. In thy son's name, we come before you, thank you, Father, for all things. Amen.
Men Israel, sons of God, patient saints, sons of God, and salute.
Most High Christ bless.
Salute down. Face sisters, to the honorable daughters of Sarah, we say shalom.
Most High Christ bless.
Is this my first time in Dallas? No, I've been here before. Yeah, well, I'm glad to be here.
I'm talking about.
I'm glad to be here. Yeah. I see Bishop Kanai's racist grandson right there. You know that boy don't like black people? He saw me last night and tried to commit suicide. He said, he was scared to death. Then when he saw Deacon Malachi, oh, Lord, he lost it. Tried to run into traffic. I don't know what's going on with these little light-skinned kids nowadays. They don't like black people. Go say something, Bishop.
Hey, shalom, family.
One, two, one.
Damn. Most High Christ bless. Happy Sabbath. So, see, Bishop said that. Nobody want to talk to me now. It was the racist family over there. Hey, it's good to be back in Dallas. We haven't been here for a while, but it's good. I'm glad to be here with leadership. It's great when we have these opportunities because it doesn't happen as often we would like because we're all doing different things concerning this gospel. So we have the opportunity to get together. Thank God for this, man. Thank God for these opportunities. You guys are going to be blessed today with what Bishop's going to bring out, that we get some edification and we become better servants. You understand that, right?
Yes,
we want the kingdom, right?
Yes,
all right, then. So let's get to work and make it happen. Bishop Yawsop.
Shalom, family. Most High in Christ bless you all. Happy Sabbath. Actually, this is not my first time here. I was here a few years ago. We had the wedding. So I was here for that one, the wedding for Officer Emmanuel and his wife. So all praise to the Most High. So I'm glad to be here again. And it's great to be in Dallas.
Well, they didn't invite me to that wedding.
Huh? Say again?
They didn't invite me. Joseph got married, right? Officer Joseph got married. He didn't invite me either. See how y'all are? All right.
No, he did.
What do you mean he did? I didn't get no invite.
No, he did.
So who got it? Oh, see?
Oh, snap.
And once again, the school is beautiful, and it's up to par. So all praise to the Lord. So glad to be here again. So we're going to enjoy ourselves the Sabbath, and we're going to get into this lesson, right? All right, all praises. All right.
Abiel, you want to say something or anything?
You do.
Hey, shalom, family. Dallas, y'all already know what time it is. I'm right up the street. Ain't been here in 2 years, but it's okay. All praise. The school is lovely. I see y'all are growing, and it's dope. Keep doing the work. Great job, Deacon Isaac. Y'all doing a fantastic job.
So Bishop is about to bring out a masterful class. So brothers, you already know what time it is. Make sure the notebooks are out, notes are taken, and y'all take this seriously. Sisters too, as well, all right? All we praise here. To the Most High. Deacon Labo.
We here, family. We're in this building. We here. Let's get this note popping. We here.
All praises. Today's topic, can you put up the thumbnail so we know what we're talking about today? So I know what I'm talking about. We're talking about Japan and Bible prophecy. Japan and Bible prophecy. Yeah, shout out to the brothers or sister that made the thumbnail. I'm not sure who made it, but I do like that one right there. We're going to open up with some little bit of history, as I often do. And some of the history you know about, because you've sat in some of the classes and some of them you may not know about. Who's reading for me today?
Officer Yakub Bishop.
Okay. Officer Yakub. All right. Isaac. He's.
Yeah, he's good. Hey, we're counting on you, bro.
Yes, sir, Deke.
No pressure.
All right. Officer Yakub, let's read this first book right here. Hey, at sundown, can I get some hot ginger tea at sundown, please? For my, I'm jacked up. Go ahead.
The Critical Review, or Annals of Literature, by a Society of Gentlemen.
All right, when was this book written? We went over this last week. Who knows the year? I'm not good in Roman numerals.
1883.
Is that the year? Oh, well, anyway, let's go into the book. somebody Google that. All right, read that. The highlight area.
Pope Nicholas V is that famous bull.
In that famous bull.
In that famous bull, by which he granted the unknown world to the Portuguese and Spaniards.
So the Portuguese and the Spaniards. Remember those two, Portuguese and the Spaniards, Scott.
Expressly permitted and ordered the Christians to reduce all infidels into slavery.
So infidel means unbelievers. If you did not believe in white supremacy Christianity, you were made a slave. Go ahead.
An order zealously executed by both these nations.
Now, I'm glad it said Christians, because when you speak to apologetics, whatever the hell they call themselves, they're quick to say that was only the Catholics. It was not the Protestants. But the Protestants, when they protested and separated from the Catholic Church, they did not undo slavery. In fact, they further enforced it. So always remember that. Go back to the book. It is warm in here. Go down, raise it up, right there.
Professor Springle divides the history of the Negro trade carried on by Christians into two principal periods, the first from 1443 to 1645, and the second from 1645 to the present time.
So the present times was 1830.
The first period.
That was a year, something like that, it's 1830-something. Got it.
The first period is the time of its increase, during which not only its founders, the Portuguese, but the English, the Dutch, and the French dealt in Negro slaves.
Now, I want y'all to notice. So it said the founders, the Portuguese, English, Dutch, and the French, got it? Dealt what?
Dealt in Negro slaves.
Uh-huh.
Though chiefly for the use of consumption of the Spaniards and the sugar and tobacco plantations in the Brazils. During the latter period, these four nations were obliged to share that trade with the Swedes.
Go ahead. Next page.
With the Swedes, the Danes, the Brandenburgers, the North Americans, and since 1778, with the Spaniards.
Now, what I want y'all to notice is that Japan is not mentioned. Go down. Japan is not mentioned. Go ahead.
The discovery of the Gold Coast served, indeed, yet more to enlarge the sphere of the navigation of the Portuguese than their slave trade. But it forced them also to extend themselves on the coast and to settle colonies in Congo, Angola, and other places, which they had till then neglected. King John II in 1492 expelled all the Jews to the island of St. Thomas.
So King John II expelled all the Jews to the island of St. Thomas, which is on the coast of Africa. Go ahead.
Which had been...
Now, the first reading, you would think those Jews is white folks. But as we read on, it's going to tell you it's not. Go ahead.
Which had been discovered in 1471 and to other Portuguese settlements on the continent of Africa. And from these banished Jews, the Black Portuguese, as they are called, and the Jews of Luango.
Luango's in Africa.
Who are despised, even by the very Negroes, are descended.
So the Jews were called the Black Portuguese. Those were all black people that was expelled to the coast of Africa. Okay, everybody see that? All right. Give me the highlighted next section.
These Negroes were purchased in Guinea, Congo, and Manicongo, and the colonists had plantations furnished with from 150 to 3,000 Negro slaves. In the beginning of the 16th century, the Spaniards and Portuguese began to transport Negroes for similar labors to the West Indies and Brazils, by which the Negro trade was rapidly increased.
Now let's go to the next book. Read that.
The Southern Literary Messenger, devoted to every department of literature and the fine arts.
What year was this published?
1860.
Let's go inside the book.
We are told that the Negro was a stranger in Egypt, an alien in a foreign land, and that in the ancient world, the alien was uniformly regarded as an enemy.
And was most?
And was most commonly reduced to slavery and that the relations in which he appears on the monuments of the Nile resulted from his position as an alien.
So they're letting you know that the Negroes in Egypt were Israelites. That's what that's saying. Next page. Zoom in at the bottom.
In respect to the monumental period, the proofs are all strong in the same direction. When the Negro races first made their appearance on the monuments of Egypt, it is in the relations of slavery.
Sometimes
indeed of capacity, but more commonly of established
captivity.
Sometimes indeed of captivity, but more commonly of established slavery. This, until we came down to our own times, was therefore the universal status. Slaves. Then.
When. Caris.
Come on, y'all. Blow it back up. Slaves, then when Carousel and Luxor were built, slaves in Europe, Asia, Africa, and America, slaves in Thebes.
Now, it mentions Asia there, but it's not being specific because Asia's huge. Good.
Slaves in Europe, Asia, Africa, and America, slaves in Thebes and Memphis, at Babylon and Nineveh, at Rome and Athens.
So these places are where the Israelites were all made slaves at. Good.
At Carthage and Constantinople, at Havana, and Richmond, slaves at all times and in all places under all forms of government.
Raise it up. Go to the right.
Under every modification of society, under every considerable combination of circumstances. Conceivable combination of circumstances. Slavery seems to have been emphatically the history of this race.
Mm. So it's saying that the Negro has always been in slavery. So when you read, hold that, give me that one in Jeremiah 2. How about is Israel a slave, that one?
The book of Jeremiah. Chapter 2 and verse 14. Is Israel a servant? Is he a homeborn slave?
Is Israel a servant? Is he a homeborn slave? Go ahead.
Why is he spoiled?
Every time you read the Bible, our people are in captivity over and over and over. Give me the next book, please. Next book.
Who's Who in Philadelphia?
Raise it up. By Charles Fred White. This was published, I want to say 1912. Yep, 1912. Give me the inside the book. Watch this. Zoom in. The Negro
learns from history that Hannibal, the world's greatest general and one of the greatest statesmen, was of Ethiopian blood.
He was black, but we found out he was an Israelite. Jump down to the next highlighted section.
That King Solomon, the wise man of our Bible, proudly acknowledged that he was black.
So Solomon admitted he was black, got it?
That the Jews were mixed with African breed and much of the beauty of their religion.
Right, because remember, some of our mothers were Canaanites. You had Jacob married Leah and Rachel. No, yeah. And then there were four concubines. Put it back on the screen. They don't need to see me. Put it back on the screen. Next section.
That Jesus Christ himself was as much a Negro as some of the race you persecute.
Y'all see that right there? So they said, can I get it? Do y'all do bombs here?
Boom.
Boom.
Come on, IT.
What is this, New York? What the hell is this?
Officer Zamar, come on.
Wow. Give me the next page. Just kill the spirit. Give me the next page. I'm going back. Go ahead.
All Japanese cultures, religion, education, the Shindayai language, etc., are distinctly Mongolian. Jim Utino brought Negroes with the sun and fire worship from Mesopotamia and through Manchuria.
Now, what I want y'all to see that part right there. Now, this is the first time we're getting into the Japanese now. All Japanese cultures, religion, what did it say? No, I'm looking over here, but I ain't got it. Oh, I want that name there. Jim Utino brought Negroes with the sun and fire worship from Mesopotamia, which is Babylon. So there was a Japanese guy named Jim Utino, okay, that brought people, Israelites, over to Japan during the time of Nebuchadnezzar. Raise it up. Read the next section.
To be a good samurai, fighting servant, one must have half black blood in one's veins.
Wait, read it again. Read it again.
To be a good samurai, fighting servant, one must have half black blood in one's veins.
Do y'all see that? Can I get a bomb on that? Do these guys know something that I don't know?
Get it together, Samar.
I guess he already knew this information already. He already knew it. That's why he's out teaching. You see all his videos. He already knew it.
You're late.
I'm late. Sorry, Zamar. We know. Bam. You're already there. Go ahead, read down.
Said the old proverb, in those days, they were not ashamed to acknowledge their black descent, but were proud of it.
That's right. So, there was a Netflix film called Yasuke. If we can put it on the screen, I don't think we'll get a flag for it because it is a, it's a trailer. So put that on the screen. Let's just take a look at it to show you that the black samurai Yasuke.
These items come from far and wide. You will be the only man on this side of the world to claim such treasures.
You dare speak to me? You will pay for your insolence.
Mate, what honor is there in striking down a child?
Stop. Pause it. I want y'all to see how the black guy, Yasuke, Yasuke means the black one. That's what it means. You see how he's dressed? These are the Portuguese. He came with the Portuguese. I'm going to get into that in a minute. Play on.
To speak?
Lord Nobunaga awards those who have proven themselves.
Because the Portuguese went to Japan.
And what do they call you? The samurai that was once a servant.
Yasuke.
You have my respect.
Yasuke is not one of us. Our people will not accept him.
I will soon represent the people, and I will usher them into a new world.
Dark army approaches.
Look at you, Yasuke. The only one who didn't betray me.
All that is left for me is an honorable death. This is my final command of you, my friend.
All right, stop it right there. Thank you, that's all I wanted out of that. Now, give me the next booklet. It's called First Impressions. I want to go to page 20. And we're going to start there and... You got a lot of reading here. Raise it up so I can see the page. That's 20. Start right there, first impressions. All right, zoom in a little closer. You can zoom in bigger than that. All right, let's read that.
First impressions. Whether apocryphal or not, the African roots of Sakanu, Tamil Romaro, raised the possibility that Africans arrived on Japanese shores prior to the arrival of Europeans and suggests that their presence in Asia was not confined to the role of manservant and slave.
That's why the last book we read, it talked about the Babylonian captivity. That's when Tenmu had taken a group up to Japan. Read on.
Chinese scholars have traced African contacts with Chinese to as far back as the Han Dynasty, 206 BC to AD 220. Paris, 1987-92. The exact date of Chinese contact with Africa is unknown. Although official contacts are thought to have begun during the Ming Dynasty, 1368 to 1644, with the maritime expeditions of the eunuch Qing Ho, 1371 to 1433.
No, that's discussing China. Keep up, keep going. I'm going to talk about Japan. Go ahead.
Scholars on both sides of the Pacific have tended to view Japan's encounter with the West as almost exclusively one between Japanese and Europeans, ignoring the fact that non-Western people were also present. In addition to Malays, East Indians, Indonesians, and Southeast Asians, there was also an African presence.
Talking about Israelites, go ahead.
Consisting of blacks who accompanied the Europeans to Japanese shores as sailors, servants, interpreters, artisans, and slaves. Images of these dark-skinned foreigners, some depicting Africans, can be found in the 17th century Namban prints.
I want you to write that down, Namban prints, N-A-N-B-A-N. You can look that up. They got a whole section on YouTube, not YouTube, on Google. Put it back on the screen. You can move me. They don't need to see me. Read on.
While Japanese artists were not above demonizing foreigners, depicting blacks and whites as oni, demons.
That's another one, right? That word, oni. Many times you'll see statues of oni. They'll show either black ones or white ones, but they show us both as demons. Go ahead.
Many of these prints are devoid of overt characterization, capturing in colorful detail the procession of Western power.
So let me explain that. So you'll see these oni demons, right? One will be black, one will be white. They're not going to have those exaggerated Negroid features. So you might look at it and just think it's a very dark deity. But in reality, it's so-called black man or black woman. That's how they portrayed us. Go ahead.
Capturing in colorful detail the procession of Western power and the place of blacks within it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's one of the pictures that, raise it up. That's one of the pictures they have us as slaves working there. Raise it up so we can read the wording. Read.
Figure 2, Momoyama period Namban from Toku Betsuten Namban Kinbun Ryoku. Special exposition, a record of encounter with the Namban culture, Kobe City Museum. 2, in the mid-19th century, artist Hashimoto Sadahide would depict the African servants of the Dutch and French in Yokohama with sympathy, dignity, and grace. A keen observer, Sadahide's written impressions of the Africans he encounters stress the similarities in customs between them and the Japanese. He describes African women as rather charm.
Raise it up. Raise it up to the next part. As rather charm. Raise it up. Was that the next part? Was right there. Charming. Charming. Thank you. Read on.
As rather charming and as bearing themselves with a sort of female dignity, declaring at the end that the African servants are no different in human nature, being kindly and compassionate. However, by the late 19th century and early 20th century, such sympathetic portraits would give way to broad caricatures.
Y'all see that? So by the 19th to 20th century, they started to make us into caricatures. Read on.
The written archive has not totally ignored the African presence. Sporadic references to Africans do appear, though for the most part, they are limited to their roles as servants and slaves, as objects of Japanese fascination.
Now notice that we were reduced to servants and slaves. Now in school, they don't talk about us ever being slaves in Japan. That part is omitted. Go ahead.
As objects of Japanese fascination and derision, who we are led to believe the Japanese viewed as an inferior, barbarous people.
See how they viewed us? Inferior and barbarous. Go ahead.
This is, after all, what the contemporary discourse on Japan has conditioned us to expect from a group of people who are today saddled with the stereotype of being xenophobic, hierarchical-minded, and racist. Sadly, We know relatively little about how pre-modern Japanese viewed Africans, or how the Africans in turn regarded their Japanese host.
Oh, I got a book on how they viewed us, but I didn't bring it out today. They hated our guts. But go ahead, read on.
What contemporary records we do have from Japanese who had some contact with Europeans and whose views of the Africans may have been tainted by Western prejudices.
So that's us working in Japan as slaves. Raise it up. See, and satirical gut. Read.
And satirical scenes. Why should blacks have been excluded? If Negroes had been depicted only as cosmic and grotesque, or comic and grotesque, or if satirical scenes had been the rule and not the exception, there might be some justification for a pejorative interpretation of the Negro in classical art. In the absence of ancient evidence to support such view, however, the suggestions must be regarded as the opinions of modern critics, not of the artists themselves.
Good. Next page. Now you see the caricature. Wait. Notice the caricatures, how it transformed. The big lips and all that, the wide faces, wide noses. That's how it transformed. That's what the writer was explaining. Raise it up. Start from historians.
Historians trace Japan's first contact with blacks to the arrival of Portuguese and Dutch traders in the 16th and 17th centuries.
Now, notice in the other book where it talks about the Portuguese and the Dutch, it never mentioned Japan. But in this book, they mention Japan. And these books, you're not going to find in your regular bookstores. All right? This one is online. Something else. Japan, a lot of these countries, they give America and Europe money not to put the actual history in their public school education regarding what transpired between black people and Japan and other countries. Read on.
However, some scholars speculate there may have been an African presence in pre-modern Japan as a result of Chinese trade with Africa during the Tang, 618 to 907.
And so you see, they're saying that we were in Japan even from back during the time of China, 618 and 907. Good.
And Song.
Song Dynasty,
960 to 1279 dynasties.
Good.
According to one sinologist, in 976, a great sensation was produced at the court of the Tang Emperor by the arrival of an Arab envoy with a Negro slave.
So the Tang Emperor was China. Good.
And after that date, Chinese books repeatedly refer to Negro slaves. And, as has already been noticed, to the Arabs.
Wait, notice that. It says Chinese books repeatedly refer to Negro slaves, but that's not taught in America. It's not taught here. Go ahead.
And has already been noticed.
If we had known that, we might not have liked Bruce Lee so much or Jet Li so much. Those are our heroes. We love them movies. And now they're making laughs out of us. Come on.
To the Arab slave trade, which produced them, citing a contemporary Chinese source, asserts that thousands of them are sold as foreign slaves. It is not inconceivable that Africans had arrived on Japanese shores via China as early as the 10th century. Wagatsuma, 1967, cites an intriguing reference to a black, presumably African, from a document produced in the late 1670s, which suggests an African presence in Japan by way of Korea. In the country of...
Wait. It said by way of Korea. So Korea was involved in this too. Go ahead.
In the country of Inaba, there was a man of 7 feet height. He was from the country of Kuro. He had been captured in the Korean War, 1592 to 1598. And brought over to Japan. His color was that of soot, and people called him Korombo. Beginning in the 16th century, one obtains documents.
So the 16th century is the 1500s, got?
Beginning in the 16th century, one obtains documented evidence of Japanese contact with Africans. In 1546, Portuguese captain Captain Jorge Alvarez brought Africans to Japan.
See, that's sort of Portuguese brought Africans to Japan. These Africans are Israelites. Good.
According to Alvarez, Japanese initial reaction to them was primarily one of curiosity. They liked seeing black people, he wrote in 1547, especially Africans, and they will come 15 leagues just to see them and entertain them for 3 or 4 days. The most well-documented case is that Yasuke.
That means the black one, a black one. Go ahead.
A Mozambican brought to Japan by the Italian Jesuit Alessandro Valignano, 1537 to 1606.
So this Yasuke was a real guy, a real brother. And he was brought there by Alessandro, a Jesuit priest, Alessandro however you say that name, in the 1500s. Go ahead.
Who was presented to Daimyo Oda Nobunaga in 1581. The first Japanese reference to Yasuke appears in Ota Gayuchi's 1527 to 1613 Shincho Koki, Chronicle of the Life of Oda Nobunaga, 1600, wherein he described as a robust young man of around 16 or 17 years of age, black as a bull, and of fine character. An account of Japanese reaction to Yasuke, written in 1584 by the Portuguese Jesuit Luis Froes, who accompanied Valignano to Kyoto, describes an incident in which the townspeople, clamoring for a glimpse of the African, broke down the doors of a Jesuit residence. The ensuing melee resulted in the death and injury of several of the participants. Upon seeing the African, Nobunaga had him stripped and bathed to determine for himself of his skin color. If his skin color was natural.
So they washed him to see if the color would come off. Good.
Perhaps more extraordinary is that Yasuke's story does not end here. Retained as an attendant by Nobunaga, he later accompanied him into battle against the rival lord, Akichi Mitsuhide, who upon defeating Nobunaga at Horyuji, spared the African and subsequently released him. Tohoku University professor Fujita Midori places the number of Africans temporarily residing in Japan during the 16th century at several hundred.
So there were several hundred of us in Japan. Go ahead.
Some came to Japan as slaves.
Raise it up.
Servants, valets, sailors, soldiers, and interpreters. Their roles were not limited to serving Europeans. Like Yasuke, a number of Africans were employed by Daimyo in various capacities as soldiers, gunners, drummers, and entertainers. Whatever their position, it appears they attracted the curious. During the Edo period, 1603 to 1867, a small number of black Africans lived in the Dutch settlement of Deshima. Despite the policy of national isolation, records reveal that black Africans mingled freely among the Japanese visitors and were allowed occasionally to leave the island, as were their European masters. Mansell Ufam, a South African historian and former diplomat at the South African Embassy in Tokyo, researching the genealogy of white European families in South Africa, has discovered a property inventory documenting the sale of one Anthony Moore from Japan, registered as the son of a Japanese mother and a Moore father, to a European settler in Cape Town in 1701.
Moore father means black, right?
Although the term Moore is racially ambiguous, and UFAM has not found documentation confirming that Anthony Moore was in fact a black African.
He was.
The finding does raise the question of the extent to which Africans mingled with the Japanese in pre-modern times, including miscegenation.
Mixing, that means mixing.
Between Japanese and black Africans. Clemens suggests that privileged African and East Indian slaves in Japan kept Japanese slaves as mistresses, as did their European masters prior to the ban on Japanese slavery by Toyotomi Hideyoshi, 1536 to 1598. In the late 16th century, 33 to 34, indeed, as late as 1598, the Portuguese missionary Luis Cerqueira reported, even the very Lascars and scullions of the Portuguese purchase and carry Japanese slaves away. Hence, it happens that many of them die on the voyage because they are heaped up upon each other. And if their masters fall sick, these masters are sometimes Kaffirs and Negroes of the Portuguese. The slaves are not cared for. These scullions give a scandalous example by living debauchery with the girls they have bought and whom some of them introduce into their cabins.
Raise it up. Let me see. I want to get to a particular name. Raise it up to the next page. Raise it up. You're at 25. 26? Let me see. Look down. Look, I'm looking. Raise it up a little bit for me. All right. I'm going to go from there. That's not what I want. It's something I wanted, but I don't see it off the top. A lot of reading. Give me the map. Yes. Can we zoom into the top right? Can you read that?
Yes, sir. Scope of the dispersion of 1873. The primary purpose of this map is to show the general direction of the principal sea routes of Arab, European, and American trade in African slaves up to 1873. The selected destinations include slave debarkation and settlements and settlement areas, ports visited by African crewmen, locations of slaves taken on home leave to England and France by slaveholders and military officers, and points in England and Canada where slaves were taken following the American War for Independence in 1783. The overland routes in Africa supplied slaves to the northern, eastern, and western coast. Those slaves who came north via the Sahara Desert normally were shipped to Arab or Muslim areas across the Mediterranean Sea. Those from the northeast to Asia via the Red Sea. Those from the East African coast to Asia and the Americas. Those from the West African coast to Europe and the Americas via the Atlantic Ocean. Selected overland routes are indicated for the trade in Asia and the Americas. Finally, a series of agreements culminating with the Treaty of 1873 legally abolished the East African trade. Earlier agreements had established the trade elsewhere in Africa. A number of Africans was among the convict labor Britain sent to Australia from England, the West Indies, Mauritius, and South Africa during the 19th century. Africans also traveled and settled overseas as traders, missionaries, soldiers, adventurers, refugees, etc. But these usually involved small, unsubstantiated, temporary movements of people prior to 1873 and are not included on this map.
Now raise it up. Let's look at the key code at the bottom. There should be a key code at the bottom. Over. All right, the legend.
Legend, principal trade and slave routes.
All right, now, move it down. I mean, yeah, lower it. Now move to my right. And find me Japan. If y'all see it, let me know. Y'all know my eyesight is bad.
Should be more to
move
the
it over.
Yeah. So Nagasaki, yeah.
Yeah, Nagasaki, where do you see it?
Yes,
okay,
there's right.
Nagasaki right yes, there. So y'all see that arrow is red there and it's purple before that or blue, whatever color that is. That's where they took the slaves, right over there. So most maps, especially in the United States school system, never explain that we were taken to Nagasaki as slaves. And that was one of the places America bombed the hell and back. Okay, give me the next page. So the green line is Portuguese slave trade routes in this picture here. Let's look at the legend at the bottom. You see, it says the green, the Portuguese trade routes, Portuguese control. All right, now let's look for Japan, Nagasaki. There also, if y'all see it, let me know. I see
it's
Asia.
Nagasaki is just below where it says Asia, China.
Okay, I see China.
Yes. Manila, Philippines, just above it. Japan, silver.
Help me out here. You know, I see Nagasaki and Japan right there on the right.
Yes, sir.
Right. Okay, y'all see that? Everybody see that, right? So that's where we were taken as slaves. Okay, now let's get into some of the images that they drew. These is before the caricatures. Right. Can we zoom in on some of them? Can y'all see the black people on the boat?
Yes, sir.
This was during the 1500s when the Pope had made that papal bull and told Portugal and Spain to reduce all infidels to slaves. Let's look at the whole picture. Come on, raise it up so we can see the whole thing, not just the top. Come on. You see the serving the food to them over there on the boat? Right? You saw on the boat, that's the Portuguese. All right, give me the next picture. Zoom in on the bottom, because it's in French. This book is in French. But you see, look at that. We got the whole umbrella over them so massive don't get heat stroke. Mm-hmm. Give me the next one. Yeah, we were carrying them. Look at the one got his hand on a little boy's head. Zoom in right there in the middle of the page. In the middle of the page. You see it? See that one? Got his hand right on his head. We had to serve these bastards. Give me the next picture. Move over so we can see. Move over. Mm-hmm. Let's get that bottom one. Raise it up. Yeah, they've been hiding this for centuries. Hiding this stuff. Let's get the next picture. Right there. Got us mining the horse. Got us unpacking the shit, the boat. The boat at the bottom. Top right, they got us holding an umbrella over that master's head. Mm-hmm. That's Japan.
So they had us in slavery in Japan. It's important to acknowledge that because just like you was bringing out, Bishop, they don't really teach this in school. You don't really get that kind of history.
Right.
So when we say that the whole world economy was built off of our backs, it includes this here also.
That's right. Let's go back. Give me the next picture. Go down. Look at their faces. Don't our people look sad and miserable? Don't look happy at all. Who's ever happy being a slave? Give me the next picture. Got to carry the teacup, the teapot. The next one. Somebody will look at this thing and say, well, at least they dressed y'all nice. The hell is this? We sitting on the ground. Give me the next, raise it up. Mm-hmm. We had to fan them, take care of them. Yep. Give me the next page. Wait, go back. Let me see. Go back to the other picture. Y'all also asked a question about their feet. Look like pillows or warm water. I don't know what that is.
It looked like their feet is on pillows. I look at that because this right here make me think of Mandingo. Who's right to say that they didn't put our little boys down there and did that and making us fan them while they were resting their feet on us?
Yep, next picture. All right, and you can see on the right, I know there's a highlight, but you still, and all black over there, there's all Jesuit priests. Those Jesuit priests had brought us and they traded us for what they wanted from the Japanese. Okay, move over. Yeah, that's them. Move over to the left. Yep. See, we got the umbrella again. Raise it up now. Look at this. Playing music for them and all that. Move it over to the right. You see the Jesuit priest right there? And all black, it's two of them. Damn Vatican priests. Give me the next picture. Okay. All at the bottom, you can see the blacks. One got the horse. One is escorting a European woman to the right next to them. It's three of them escorting her. The next one to it, you got three escorting two Europeans, and you got three blacks on the far right. Raise it up. Again, this is not going to be shown to you in school. Raise it up. Next picture. Okay, those are Japanese women right there. Raise it up. And you got the slaves there with some of the Europeans, the Portuguese at the bottom. Next picture. Okay. This one, you got us mingled in there. Still serving. Like, look at the devil on the couch that we're look at in with the umbrella. Y'all see the umbrella? When you go down. No. Center. We're carrying him and got the umbrella over his head. Y'all don't see that? Where was Galatians 3:28 then?
You can see where they bared him on the shoulders.
Yeah.
Look at where the rods are that holding up the carriage and got this skunt. No, let me be quiet. That's a Jamaican term there. But you see our people carrying it with the things on their shoulders, and they got to suspend this thing walking.
Yep. Next picture. Again, making sure the sun don't get on them. Don't get on Massa. Raise it up. Give me the next picture. Mm-hmm. So again, they don't show you this in school, and you know church definitely ain't gonna talk about this. All right, so now let's discuss the biblical origin of the Japanese, shall we? And what the Most High prophesies will happen to them in the end. We're gonna open up with Genesis chapter 19. Genesis chapter 19. That took us a good while there. Genesis chapter 19, let's start at verse 30.
The book of Genesis, chapter 19 and verse 30. And Lot went up out of Zoar and dwelt in the mountain, and his two daughters with him. For he feared to dwell in Zoar, and he dwelt in a cave.
Now this is after Sodom and Gomorrah was destroyed. The angel told him to go into the mountain, so Lot said, can I go to this mountain over here in Zoar? Go ahead.
And he dwelt in a cave, he and his two daughters. And the firstborn said unto the younger, our father is old. There is not a man in the earth to come in unto us after the manner of all the earth. Come, let us make.
Because they thought everybody was dead. Go ahead.
Come, let us make our father to drink wine. Let us make our father drink wine, and he will, and we will lie with him.
Because the plan was, let's get our daddy drunk, have sex with him so we can get pregnant and have children and repopulate the earth. That was their mentality. Go ahead.
That we may preserve seed of our father. And they made their father drink wine that night. And the firstborn went in and lay with her father. And he perceived not when she was laid down, nor when she arose. And it came to pass on the morrow that the firstborn said unto the younger, behold, I lay yesternight with my father. Let us make him drink wine this night also. And go thou in and lie with him, that we may preserve seed of our father. And they made their father to drink wine that night also. And the younger arose and lay with him, and he perceived not when she lay down, nor when she arose. Thus were both the daughters of Lot with child by their father. And the firstborn bare a son and called his name Moab, the same as the father of the Moabites unto this day. And the younger She also bare a son and called his name Ben-Ami, the same as the father of the children of Ammon unto this day.
Now, let's go look up Mongoloid. I sent you the link already. We just want to look up Mongoloid because that's one of the effects or side effects of incest. When you have sex with someone close in relation, like a father and daughter, mother and son, generally what occurs is, it's going to tell you here. Read that.
Mongoloid is an obsolete racial grouping of various people indigenous to large parts of Asia, the Americas, and some regions in Europe and Oceania. The term is derived from a now disproven theory of biological race. In the past, other terms such as Mongolian race, yellow, Asiatic, and Oriental have been used as synonyms.
Hey, is that the link that I sent y'all? Yes, that is, right? Okay, go ahead. Keep going.
The concept of dividing humankind into the Mongoloid, Caucasoid, and Negroid races was introduced in the 1780s by members of the Göttingen School of History. It was further developed by Western scholars in the context of racist ideologies during the age of colonialism. With the rise of modern genetics, the concept of distinct human races in a biological sense has become obsolete. In 2019, the American Association of Biological Anthropologists stated, "The belief in races as natural aspects of human biology and the structures of inequality, racism, that emerge from such beliefs are among the most damaging elements in the human experience, both today and in the past."
Oh, this is the part I wanted right here. Read that.
The term Mongoloid has a second usage referencing people with Down syndrome.
Now, many times that often happens when you have incest. Now, today, of course, I'm not discussing anything about vaccines that may cause it or any kind of medical effect. The term Mongoloid has a second usage referencing people with Down syndrome. When Lot slept with his daughters, the children got what's called, that's what they call Mongoloids. Like China, Japanese, they're called Mongolians or Mongoloids. Am I pronouncing it right? Yes. And they have what's called a functioning Down syndrome. Now, then, I call them stupid, but they're not what we would call slow, mentally slow. Because remember, what does Genesis mean, brothers? The beginning. It was the beginning of two races. Read that bottom part again. The
term Mongoloid has a second usage referencing people with Down syndrome, now generally regarded as highly offensive. Those affected were often referred to as Mongoloids.
See that? They were always known as Mongoloids, Chinese and Japanese. Go ahead.
Or in terms of Mongolian idiocy or Mongolian imbecility.
Exactly. Now let's go to the next book, which was published in 1938. Give me the next book. Pay close attention. Read that.
The Japanese, Who Are They?
Raise it up.
By Thomas W. Plant.
Let's go inside the book. We're going to page 17. Zoom in. All I want is the highlighted area in the red box.
Yes, sir.
Read.
The late Landseer McKenzie was one of those friends, and after a careful study of the whole of the arguments contained in the pamphlet, he stated that he considered the author had definitely established his case, namely, that the Japanese are the children of Ammon.
Can I get a bomb? Thank you. Do y'all see that? People think like they already knew this stuff already. All right, okay. Give me the next page, 22. I want the box, the highlighted box. Start in tracing.
In tracing,
shrink it just a little bit. Yeah.
In tracing the Japanese race back to Ben-Ami.
Ben-Ami was the second son. Go ahead.
The younger son of Lot. I have established my cause by giving you the genealogical tree of the said Ben-Ami without a break in the chain of evidence, right back to his great progenitor, Shem, the eldest son of Noah. This pedigree, strange to say, being also that of Isaac, the son of Abraham, who was the uncle of Lot. By this tree, worked out on page 18, you will see at once that Japan and China versus Ben-Ami and Moab of old are of Shemitic origin.
Y'all see that right there? Give me the next page. Highlighted area, let's zoom in. Go ahead.
The reference in the legend includes an important identification which shows that we are correct in tracing Japan to Ammon.
Mm-hmm. Give me the next page, page 27.
We venture to think that we have now made out a case for the identification of Japan with the children of Ammon, and to have given sufficient reasons and evidences to account for the Israelitish similarities being found among the Japanese by Professor Odlum. It is useless to look at the west of Europe as some do for Moab and Ammon, when the Bible predicted that they should be sent eastward.
They would be sent eastward. Go ahead.
This proving of Japan to be the children of Ammon carries with it the claim that the Chinese are the children of Moab.
Can I get a bump? Thank you. Thank you. Give me the next. Let's read this.
Both analyses demonstrated genetic evidence of the origin of Koreans from the Central Asian Mongolians.
Mongolians is that term again. Go ahead.
Further, the Koreans are more closely related to the Japanese and quite distant from the Chinese.
So the Koreans are what? Ammonites. They belong to Ammon. Mm. Ammon. Everybody got that?
Yes, sir.
All right. Let's give me Deuteronomy 23:3. Deuteronomy 23:3.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 23 and verse 3. An Ammonite or Moabite shall not enter into the congregation of the Lord. Even to their 10th generation shall they not enter into the congregation of the Lord.
Why?
Forever.
Go ahead.
Because they met you not with bread and with water in the way when you came forth out of Egypt. And because they hired against thee Balaam, the son of Beor, of Pethor, of Mesopotamia, to curse thee.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Nevertheless, the Lord thy God would not hearken unto Balaam, but the Lord thy God turned the curse into a blessing unto thee, because the Lord thy God loved thee.
Right, so Balaam wanted to curse us. Give me that priest, Numbers 23:23, I think it is. Numbers 23, this for you voodoo practitioners out there. Is it 23:23? Yeah, that's it.
Yes, sir. The book of Numbers, chapter 23 and verse 23. Surely there is no enchantment against Jacob.
When brothers and sisters are keeping the commandments, there's no enchantment that can work against us. This is what Balaam was telling Balak. Go ahead.
Surely there is no enchantment against Jacob. Neither is there any divination against Israel. According to this time, it shall be said of Jacob and of Israel, what hath God wrought?
Because we're his peculiar people. Give me Psalms 83, we're his chosen. Psalms 83, let's start at 1. Yes, sir.
The book of Psalms, chapter 83 and verse 1.
Mm-hmm.
Keep not thy silence, keep not thou silence, O God.
So here, David is asking the Lord not to keep silence. Read it again.
Keep not thou silence, O God.
I'm sorry, this is Asaph. Asaph, I apologize. Read it again.
Keep not thou silence, O God. Hold not thy peace, and be not still, O God.
Come on.
For lo, thine enemies make a tumult.
So the enemies of God make a tumult against God. Go ahead.
And they that hate thee have lifted up the head.
They've lifted up the head in society, which goes back to watch this. Hold that. Give me Deuteronomy 28:43.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28 and verse 43.
Mm-hmm.
The stranger that is within thee shall get up above thee very high, and thou shalt come down very low.
So the other nations got up above us very high. We came down very low as slaves. Go ahead.
He shall lend to thee,
uh-huh,
and thou shalt not lend to him.
Read.
He shall be the head, and thou shalt be the tail.
So now let's go back to Psalms 83. and 2 again.
Psalms chapter 83 and verse 2. For lo, thine enemies make a tumult, and they that hate thee have lifted up the head.
So they've lifted up the head as the head of society. They've lifted up the head as the leaders of the world. Lifted up the head. The white man lifted up his head as God and Christ, in fact. Go ahead.
They have taken crafty counsel against thy people.
Write this down. The beginning of their crafty counsel is slavery. That's the beginning of their crafty counsel. From there, they built all their banking systems upon the free centuries of slave labor. From those banking institutions, they built militaries and educational institutions. They built they created whole, what is it called? Infrastructures of society. It was built upon us. Read that again.
They have taken crafty counsel against thy people and consulted against thy hidden ones.
We're the hidden ones. Even the fact that we were slaves in Japan has been hidden. Go ahead.
They have said, come and let us cut them off from being a nation.
So the nations that hate God said, let's cut them off from being a nation. Go ahead.
That the name of Israel may be no more in remembrance.
They wanted us to forget that we're the Israelites. All nations took a hand in this. Go ahead.
For they have consulted together with one consent.
Mm-hmm. One agreement. They all agreed.
They are confederate against
Read.
The tabernacles of Edom.
Edom is the so-called white man. He's the first of the nations on God's hit list. Go ahead.
And the Ishmaelites.
The Ishmaelites are the Arabs. They are the second on God's hit list.
Of Moab.
That's the Chinese. They're the third on God's hit list. Go ahead.
And the Hagarenes.
That's the Hamite Egyptians. They're the fourth on his hit list. Go ahead.
Gebal.
Those are the Hamites. Go ahead.
And Ammon.
Ammon, that's what I wanted to get to, too. They're on God's hit list as well. Give me Ezekiel 25 and 1.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 25 and verse 1. The word of the Lord came again unto me, saying, Son of man, set thy face against the Ammonites.
Who are the Ammonites, brothers? Did you hear the confusion in Dallas over here? Did y'all hear the confusion in Dallas? Who? Thank you. Woo. Whoa, the whole hour I was going through that. I heard like 8 different answers.
You got visitors in the crowd.
Bishop. Oh, Bishop.
Visitors said that?
Thank
visitors?
You, Isaac.
That was visitors?
Thank you, Isaac.
Wow. All right, in this section here, raise your hand if you're from Dallas. Uh-oh. All right, look at all them Dallas people.
Why they taking their time, Bishop?
Yeah, they're getting slow. All right, okay. Now, where are we at? Made me forget where I'm at.
Verse
Ezekiel 25 and 1. Go ahead.
Verse 1. The book of Ezekiel, chapter 25 and verse 1. The word of the Lord came again unto me, saying, Son of man, set thy face against the Ammonites, and prophesy against them.
Set thy face against the Japanese and prophesy against them. So the Japanese also includes Korea, South Korea, and North Korea. They are all Ammon. Everybody with me there?
Yes, sir.
Woo, Lord have mercy. Read on.
And say unto the Ammonites, hear the word of the Lord God. Thus saith the Lord God, because thou saidest, aha, against my sanctuary when it was profaned, and against the land of Israel when it was desolate, and against the house of Judah when they went into captivity.
So Ammon mocked us when we went into slavery under Nebuchadnezzar. They laughed at us. Give me that Lamentations 2:16.
Sir. The book of Lamentations, chapter 2 and verse 16. All thine enemies have opened their mouth against thee. They hiss and gnash the teeth. They say, we have swallowed her up. Certainly, this is the day that we looked for. We have found. We have seen it.
Read.
The Lord hath done that which he had devised.
Because the Lord devised destruction on us because we broke his commandments. Cut.
He hath fulfilled his word in that he commanded in the days of old. Or he hath fulfilled his word that he commanded in the days of old. He hath thrown down and hath not pitied. He hath caused thine enemy to rejoice over thee.
So Ammon rejoiced over us as well. Go ahead.
He hath set up the horn of thine adversary.
Our enemies exalted themselves. Let's go back. Ezekiel 25, verse 4.
Ezekiel chapter 25 and verse 4. Behold, therefore I will deliver thee to the men of the east for a possession. And they shall set their palaces in thee and make their dwellings in thee. They shall eat thy fruit and they shall drink thy milk.
Read it again.
Behold, therefore I will deliver thee to the men of the east for a possession.
So the men of the east for a possession. Go ahead. Babylon, go ahead.
And they shall set their palaces in thee.
Now the men of the east are also Arabs. And they shall set, this is the part I want you to look at. And they, read that again.
And they shall set their palaces in thee and make their dwellings in thee. They shall eat thy fruit and they shall drink thy milk.
Watch this. Hold on. Wait a minute. Hold on. I'm going to show y'all something. I'm going to get back to the verse in a minute. But give me Ezekiel 21:19. I'm going to come back to explain that. But I just want to show y'all this first.
The book of Ezekiel. Chapter 21 and verse 19.
Mm-hmm.
Also, thou son of man, appoint thee two ways, that the sword of the king of Babylon may come.
Both, so Nebuchadnezzar was coming. Go ahead.
Both twain shall come forth out of one land.
Uh-huh.
And choose thou a place. Choose it at the head of the way to the city. Appoint a way, that the sword may come to Rabbath of the Ammonites.
So Rabbath was the capital of Ammon. Go ahead.
And to Judah and Jerusalem, the defense.
Jerusalem was our capital. Go ahead.
For the king of Babylon stood at the parting of the way.
So he stood at the parting of the way. Go ahead.
And at the head of the two ways.
Not and. It doesn't say and.
At the head of two ways.
At the head of two ways. So he was, Nebuchadnezzar was trying to decide, who should I destroy first, Ammon or Judah? That was his, he had to decide that. Read on.
To use divination, he made his arrows bright. He consulted with images. He looked in the liver.
So he was doing witchcraft. Go ahead.
At his right hand was the divination for Jerusalem.
Uh-huh.
To appoint captains, to open the mouth and the slaughter, to lift up the voice with shouting, to appoint battering rams against the gates, to cast a mount and to build a fort. And it shall be unto them as a false divination in their sight, to them that have sworn oaths. But he will call to remembrance the iniquity that they may be taken.
So God's plan was that Nebuchadnezzar take down Judah first. Let's go back. Ezekiel 25.
Yes, sir.
And read verse 4 one more time.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 25 and verse 4. Behold, therefore I will deliver thee into the men of the east for a possession.
So now that is talking about Nebuchadnezzar. Go ahead.
And they shall set their palaces in thee.
Now, this part here is going into the Arabs. Write this down, Arabs. I'm going to show you. And they
shall set their palaces in thee and make their dwellings in thee. They shall eat thy fruit, and they shall drink thy milk.
Now, watch this. Give me the map. First map. Yes, put it on the screen. All right, do y'all see Ammon, Moab, and Edom? Y'all see them three, right?
Yes, sir.
So we're talking about Ammon today, but I do want y'all to see Moab and Ammon also. We're focusing on Ammon. So remember, Nebuchadnezzar was going to come against Judah. Then he was going to get Ammon. Give me the next map. Can y'all zoom in? I want y'all to see Ammon. Y'all see Ammon right there? You see Moab?
Yes, sir.
You see Edom? What is that area called today?
Jordan.
What is Jordan? The Jordan. Now, watch this. So who owns Jordan today? Anybody know? Huh? Ishmael owns all of that. Ishmael took all of that. That's the Arabs. Okay. What? Now give me this, the next thing from the New World Encyclopedia.
The history of Jordan... The history of Jordan refers to the history.
Wait. No. Not that one. It says Jimmu, emperor. Yes, that one right there. Watch this.
Jimmu, emperor of Japan. Emperor Jimmu, Jinmu Tino, also known as Kamu Yamato Iwabiko, given name, Waka Mikino.
Just get to the actual reading.
Yes, sir. Born according to the legendary account in the Kojikai on the first day of the first month, 1660 BCE.
Now, that year, those years are not exactly accurate, because this was around Babylon's time, so it should be 606, but go ahead.
660 BCE, and died again, according to the legend, on the 11th day of the third month, 585 BCE.
Mm-hmm.
Both dates, according to the traditional Japanese calendar, was the mythical founder of Japan and is the first emperor named in the traditional list of emperors. The Imperial House of Japan traditionally based its claim to the throne on its descent from Jimmu.
Mm-hmm. That's where the Japanese based their descent from. He's the first founder of Japan. Why? Because during Babylon's time, he went up to that era that they call Japan today. Go ahead.
The name Emperor Jimmu is treated as the posthumous name of this mythical figure. In fact, being Chinese in form and Buddhist in implication, it must have been awarded centuries after the lifetime ascribed to him as part of the compilation of legends about the origins of the Yamato dynasty known as the Kojikai. Jimmu literally means divine might.
Let's go back. Give me the next map, please. Next, Wikipedia, Jordan, history of Jordan. That's what I want. Let's read that.
History of Jordan. The history of Jordan refers to the history of the Hashemite kingdom of Jordan.
So Hashemite. Ha, write this down. Ha means the. Shemite means people of Shem. The Shemite kingdom of Jordan. These are the Arabs it's talking about here. Read it again.
The history of Jordan refers to the history of the Hashemite kingdom of Jordan and the background period of the Emirate of Transjordan under British protectorate, as well as the general history of the region of Transjordan.
So we're going to talk about Transjordan. Go ahead.
There is evidence of human activity in Transjordan as early as the Paleolithic period. The area was settled by nomadic tribes in the Bronze Age, which consolidated in small kingdoms during the Iron Age.
Look at the area of Transjordan. Go ahead.
Such as the Ammonites, Moabites, and Edomites.
That's the Transjordan region. The area that used to be Ammonites, Moabites, and Edomites. Give me the next thing about demographics. Go from there. Right there. Read that.
Demographics of Jordan. Jordan has a population of more than 11.1 million inhabitants as of 2023. Jordanians are the citizens of Jordan. Around 94% of Jordanians are Arabs.
That's all I want right there. 94% of Jordanians are Arabs. So when we go back, let's go back now. Let's go on back to Ezekiel 25 and verse 4. There's a lot in that verse.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 25 and verse 4. Behold, therefore, I will deliver thee to the men of the east for
a possession. That's Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar.
And they shall set their palaces in thee.
The Arabs set their palaces in Ammon. Go ahead.
And make their dwellings in thee. They shall eat thy fruit, and they shall drink thy milk.
So the Arabs took over. The Ishmael took over that whole area. They took, when Nebuchadnezzar ran them up out of there, the Arabs came in and took over the area of Ammon. They took that area. They took over the area of what was under Ammon? Moab, and then you had Edom beneath that. Today they call that region Jordan. The Jordan. Everybody with me so far?
Sir.
All right. Read on. What verse you at?
Verse 5.
Yes, go ahead.
And I will, verse 5. And I will make Rabbah a stable for camels, and the Ammonites a couching place for flocks.
Because the Arabs took it over. Go ahead.
Sorry. A couching place for flocks, and ye shall know that I am the Lord. For thus saith the Lord God, because thou hast clapped thine hands and stamped with thy feet, and rejoiced in heart with all thy despite against the land of Israel.
That's what we read earlier in Lamentations 2:16. Let's read Lamentations 2:16 again so we get the thought.
The book of Lamentations, chapter 2 and verse 16. All thine enemies have opened their mouth against thee. They hiss and gnash the teeth. They say, we have swallowed her up. Certainly this is the day that we looked for. We have found, we have seen it.
Let's go back.
Ezekiel 25 and 6 again.
Ezekiel chapter 25 and verse 6. For thus saith the Lord God, because thou hast clapped thine hands and stamped with thy feet.
So they clapped their hands and stomped their feet when Nebuchadnezzar took us into slavery. Go ahead.
And rejoiced in heart with all thy despite.
And the Japanese day was happy as hell when we was taken down. Go ahead.
And against the land of Israel.
Go ahead.
Therefore, I will stretch out my hand upon thee.
Now the Lord said, he's going to stretch out his hand upon Ammon. Go ahead.
And will deliver thee for a spoil to the heathen.
That's right, Nebuchadnezzar. Go ahead.
And I will cut thee off from the people, and I will cause thee to perish out of the countries. I will destroy thee, and thou shalt know that I am the Lord.
So once Nebuchadnezzar got finished with us, and Ammon was so damn happy, the Lord had Nebuchadnezzar now turn on them. That's what happened. Give me Ezekiel 21:28.
The book of Ezekiel.
Wait, let me get it. Yes, sir. Ezekiel 21:28. Now this is, this is future prophecy now, right here.
The book of Ezekiel.
So this Babylon here is going into Babylon, the United States of America. Go ahead.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 21 and verse 28. And thou, son of man, prophesy and say, thus saith the Lord God concerning the Ammonites.
Who are the Ammonites, brothers? Very good. Read.
And concerning their reproach.
Uh-huh.
Even say thou, the sword is drawn, for the slaughter it is furbished to consume because of the glittering.
Read.
Whilst they see vanity unto thee, whilst they divine a lie unto thee.
Because the Japanese are good to as being damn liars. That's what it said. Read it again.
Whilst they see vanity unto thee, whilst they divine a lie unto thee, to bring thee upon the necks of them that are slain, of the wicked, whose day is come, when their iniquity shall have an end.
When their iniquity shall have an end. Watch this.
Shall I cause it to return into its sheath?
Shall the Lord cause his judgment to return into a sheath? Meaning like a sword goes into a sheath. Everybody understand the symbolism? Yes, read again.
Shall I cause it to return into his sheath? I will judge thee in the place where thou wast created, in the land of thy nativity.
I need you to read it again. You just messed it up. I need it read right. Read again. Yes, sir.
Shall I cause it to return into his sheath? I will judge thee in the place where thou wast created, in the land of thy nativity.
Where were they created, brothers? Get Genesis 19:22 again. We read it. Hey, Isaac.
I think these brothers is just nervous, Bishop.
They ain't not nervous. Impossible to be nervous.
Either
no.
Nervous or not it's, studying.
Be quiet. Read Genesis 19:22 again.
The book of Genesis, chapter 19 and verse 22. Haste thee, escape thither, for I cannot do anything till thou become thither. Therefore, the name of the city was called Zoar.
Zoar is where his daughters slept with him and had babies. Everybody with me? Yes, sir. Lord have mercy. That was their nativity. Let's go on back to Genesis 21:30.
Oh. The book of Ezekiel, chapter 21 and verse 30. Shall I cause it to return into his sheath? I will judge thee in the place where thou wast created, in the land of thy nativity.
You know what the Lord is saying? That in this last world's war, he's going to have Moab and Japan return to that area again and kill them right there. That's what he said. He's going to destroy them in the same place they was born. I'm going to kill you there. That's what's going to happen in this third world's war Armageddon. Everybody understand me? Oh, Lord, read on.
And I will pour out mine indignation upon thee.
Mm-hmm.
I will blow against thee in the fire of my wrath.
The fire of God's wrath was not Nebuchadnezzar. The fire of the Lord's wrath is when Christ returned, when the nations are at war. Go ahead. That's like the new Babylon. Go ahead.
And deliver thee into the hand of brutish men and skillful to destroy.
It's the white man that's skillful to destroy. He's the one that got all kind of technology. Chemical warfare and all of that. Right. Biological warfare. He's the one skillful to destroy. Go ahead.
Thou shalt be for fuel to the fire.
Do you see that right there? Read it again.
Thou shalt be for fuel to the fire.
Wait, I need Isaiah. I need that one in Isaiah. Is it 9 and 6? Somebody help me.
It says, this shall be fuel. Mm-hmm. 9 and 5, thank you.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 9 and verse 5. For every battle of the warrior is with confused noise.
Read it again.
For every battle of the warrior is with confused noise.
And right, because when you're fighting, it's confusion of noise. Everybody fighting, right? And no matter what war you ever saw, it's confusion. But watch. Go ahead.
And garments rolled in blood.
Uh-huh, but here it comes.
But this shall be with burning and fuel of fire.
This is going to be a different war. This war that the Lord's talking about is different. It's going to be with what? With burning and fuel of fire. Let's go on back to Ezekiel.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 21 and verse 32. Thou shalt be for fuel to the fire.
Mm.
Thy blood shall be in the midst of the land.
Y'all see that? Thy blood shall be in the midst of the land. Go ahead.
Thou shalt be no more remembered, for I, the Lord, have spoken.
I, the Lord, have spoken. From there, give me Jeremiah 25, 13. Jeremiah 25, 13.
The book of Jeremiah, chapter 25 and verse 13. And I will bring upon that land all my words which I have pronounced against it, even all that is written in this book, which Jeremiah hath prophesied against all the nations.
So Jeremiah prophesied against all the nations. Read on.
For many nations and great kings shall serve themselves of them also.
Mm-hmm.
And I will recompense them according to their deeds and according to the works of their own hands. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel unto me, take the wine cup of the fury at my hand.
Oh, hold on. Give me Isaiah 51 and 17, I think, about the cup of this fury.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 51 and verse 17. Awake, awake, stand up, O Jerusalem, which has drunk at the hand of the Lord the cup of his fury. Thou hast drunken the dregs of the cup of trembling, and wrung them out.
So this cup is symbolic. It's not a literal cup that Jeremiah ran around and said, hey, King, can you sip on this cup? No, it was symbolic. It's just like when the Lord said in Ezekiel, tell them whether they will hear or forbear. Like Paul said, to preach in and out of season, meaning whether they will hear or forbear. Everybody understand that?
Yes, sir.
Like when Christ said, can you drink the cup that I have to drink? He said, indeed you shall drink. It was not a literal cup. It was symbolic or a metaphor or an allegory or a parable of something you have to go through. Go back to Jeremiah. So now he's talking about telling nations to drink this cup. Verse 15 again.
Yes, sir.
Jeremiah chapter 25 and verse 15. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel unto me, take the wine of this cup.
Take the wine cup.
Take the wine cup of this fury at my hand and cause all the nations to whom I send thee to drink it.
So what he's saying, just go to them and prophesy. That's what he's saying. Whether they want to hear it or not. Go ahead.
And they shall drink and be moved and be mad because of the word that I will send among them.
They're going to be pissed off when it says mad. They're going to be mad. But Jeremiah said, what do you mean we're going to be destroyed? What do you mean we're going to be taken down? Go ahead.
Then took I the cup at the Lord's hand and made all the nations to drink, unto whom the Lord had sent me, to wit, Jerusalem.
That was the first nation he went to, our people, right?
And the cities of Judah, and the kings thereof, and the princes thereof, to make them a desolation, and astonishment, and hissing, and a curse, as it is this day. Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and his servants, and his princes, and all his people.
And so Egypt's going to get it? Go ahead.
And all the mingled people.
The mingled people is Keturah's son, Abraham's kids with Keturah. Go ahead.
And all the kings of the land of Uz.
That's Jordan. Go ahead.
And all the kings of the land of the Philistines.
Uh-huh, that's Palestine. Go ahead.
And Ashkelon.
Mm-hmm, that's in Israel.
And Azah.
That's in Israel. Go ahead. I mean, Azah, write this down. Gaza. That's in Israel, too. Gaza. Azah is Gaza. Go ahead.
And Ekron.
Uh-huh, that's in the land of Israel.
And the remnant of Ashdod.
That's right. Go ahead.
Edom.
Mm-hmm.
And Moab. And the children of Ammon.
Ammon going to get it, too. That's what we want. Ammon going to get it. Go ahead.
And all the kings of Tyrus.
Tyrus is Lebanon. Go ahead.
And all the kings of Zidon.
That's Lebanon as well.
And the kings of the isles, which are beyond the sea.
Go ahead.
Dedan and Tema and Buz and all that are in the utmost corners.
These are your Arabs. Next verse is going to tell you.
And all the kings of Arabia and all the kings of the mingled people that dwell in the, desert.
That's Keturah's kids again. Go ahead.
And all the kings of Zimri,
mm-hmm.
and all the kings of Elam.
Elam, that goes into Pakistan, India. Go ahead.
And all the kings of the Medes.
That's Iran. Go ahead. Iraq. Go ahead.
And all the kings of the North.
The kings of the North is NATO. That's France, Germany, London, England. Go ahead.
Far and near,
mm-hmm.
one with another. And all the kingdoms of the world, which are upon the face of the earth. And the king of Shishak.
Write this down. Shishak is the United States of America. It's a metaphor. Go ahead.
Shall drink after them.
Here's the proof. Jeremiah 51:41. In case of how you know Shishak is Babylon. Jeremiah 51:41. Read that.
The book of Jeremiah, chapter 51 and verse 41. How is Shishak taken? And how is the praise of the whole earth surprised? How has Babylon become an astonishment among the nations?
Y'all see that? So it's telling you Babylon is the praise of the whole earth. Today, Iraq is not the praise of the whole earth. Back in the day, they were. But today, they're not. Read that again.
How is Shishak taken? And how is the praise of the whole earth surprised? How has Babylon become an astonishment among the nations?
Go ahead.
The sea has come upon Babylon. She is covered with the multitude of the waves thereof.
Talking about the nations going to come against her. Go ahead.
Her cities are a desolation, a dry land, and a wilderness, a land wherein no man dwelleth, neither doth any son of man pass thereby.
Do people live in Iraq today? So, you know, this ain't talking about that place. This place we're reading about is the United States of America, and it's yet to come to pass. Let's go back. So it's a prophecy, prophecy. Let's go back. Where did you read down to?
We read down to verse 26.
Go ahead.
The book of Jeremiah, chapter 25 and verse 26. And all the kings of the north, far and near, one with another, and all the kingdoms of the world which are upon the face of the earth, and the king of Shishak shall drink after them.
Mm.
Therefore, thou shalt...
Wait, read that part again.
And the king of Shishak shall drink after them.
So the king of Shishak shall drink after all those nations we read about. Shishak's going to get it last. America going to get it last. Go ahead.
Therefore, thou shalt say unto them, thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, drink ye and be drunken and spew.
Spew means vomit. Go ahead.
And fall and rise no more because of the sword which I will send among you.
Come on.
And it shall be, if they refuse to take the cup at thine hand to drink, then shalt thou say unto them, thus saith the Lord of hosts, ye shall certainly drink.
So that's whether they will hear or forbear. So he was not going around with a cup saying, here, Ammon, Moab, drink this. Drink it. No, he was prophesying. Right. It was the word of God, whether they want to hear it or not. They're going to drink it. They're going to drink everything this Bible says. Go ahead.
For lo, I begin to bring evil on the city which is called by my name.
See that? I will begin to bring evil on the city which is called by my name. That's Jerusalem. Go ahead.
And should ye be utterly unpunished?
And should all those other nations be unpunished? Go ahead.
Ye shall not be unpunished.
You shall not be unpunished.
For I will call a sword upon thee, upon all the inhabitants of the earth, saith the Lord of hosts.
See, you know what's good about that verse? People say, well, nations can do this nation. No. God said if he punished his nation, his people, how in the hell are these other nations not going to get it too?
Right. That's right.
Mm. They've done worse than we did.
Right.
Go ahead, read on.
Therefore, prophesy thou against them
it's
all
like,
these
you know,
words.
I'm sorry. I got to just reflect back. When people go, but there's good white folks. Daniel was righteous. Did he go into slavery?
Yes, sir.
Not only that, he had his wiener cut off. He was a eunuch. Ezekiel was righteous. Did he go into slavery? Yes, he did. So wait a minute. So the righteous men of Israel, our people, went into slavery, but not the good white folks. Not them. No, sir, Master. No, sir.
That's a very testament to how messed up the slavery did us.
We're more worried about letting some of them get off, and all of our asses got whipped. Not an ass was spared among us.
That's right.
But we're trying to protect their behinds. The curse worked.
Where we at?
Verse 30.
Go ahead.
Therefore, prophesy thou against them all these words, and say unto them, the Lord shall roar from on high.
The Lord shall roar from on high. Give me that in Isaiah 42:13.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 42 and verse 13. The Lord shall go forth as a mighty man.
The Lord shall go forth as a mighty man. Good.
He shall stir up jealousy like a man of war.
That's right. Come on.
He shall cry, yea, roar. He shall prevail against his enemies.
You see that? He shall cry, yea, roar. He shall prevail against his enemies. Let's go back.
Jeremiah chapter 25 and verse 30.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore prophesy thou against them all these words, and say unto them, the Lord shall roar from on high, and utter his voice from his holy habitation.
That's right. Come on.
He shall mightily roar upon his habitation. He shall give a shout as they that tread the grapes against all the inhabitants of the earth.
Get that one in Isaiah 63, 1 to 5. He going to roar like they that tread the grapes.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 63. You said verse 5, Bishop?
1 to 5.
1 through 5. The book of Isaiah, chapter 63. Verse 1.
Do you have any images here in Dallas, Isaac?
They should. They should have a folder. Come on, IT. Wake up.
Go ahead. Read on.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 63 and verse 1. Who is this that cometh from Edom with dyed garments from Bozrah?
Hey, can you find me a map of Bozrah? Bozrah. Find me a map. Find me a map of Bozrah. I want y'all to see the land masses. Edom, Bozrah. Bozrah today. Y'all should have a folder because I've gone over this chapter many times. There's a map that shows Edom, which is in Bozrah, which is in Jordan. We just discussed it. I also showed you a map. I gave you a map, and I believe, if I'm not mistaken, the map you showed earlier, yes, put it on the screen. Any day now, come on. Wow. All right, y'all see Bozrah in the land of Edom right there. This is where the Third World War is going to take this whole region, not just there, but all that whole section over there. So read that again.
Who is this that cometh from Edom with dyed garments from Bozrah? This that is glorious in his apparel, traveling in the greatness of his strength? I that speak in righteousness, mighty to save.
So Isaiah is asking a question, and the Lord responds. When he asks this, who is this traveling in the greatness and the strength? The Lord responds, I that speak in righteousness, mighty to save. That's Christ. Go ahead.
Wherefore art thou red in thine apparel?
Now Isaiah's asking a question because he sees the vision. He says, why are you red? Why are your garments red? Go ahead.
And thy garments like him that treadeth in the wine.
You look like you just finished treading grapes. Go ahead.
I have trodden the wine press alone.
I have trodden the wine press alone.
And of the people there was none with me.
Wait. Give me Revelation 19:13 real quick.
The book of Revelation, chapter 19 and verse 13. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God.
Do y'all see what the grapes symbolize in that verse? What it symbolizes, brothers? Blood. Now go back and read 2 again.
Isaiah chapter 63 and verse 2. Wherefore art thou red in thine apparel?
Why do you got blood all on your garments? That's what he's asking. Go ahead.
And thy garments like him that treadeth in the wine.
You look like you were splashing in grapes. Go ahead.
I have treaded I have trodden the winepress alone.
I stomped these people alone. I killed people by myself. That's what he's saying. I'm doing the killing. Go ahead.
And of the people, there was none with me.
I didn't need none of you Israelites' help at all. Killing. What are you talking about? Give me the Isaiah 66:15.
The book of Isaiah.
That's killing. The Lord is going to kill.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 66 and verse 15. For behold, the Lord will come with fire and with his chariots like a whirlwind to render his anger with fury and his rebuke with flames of fire. For by fire and by his sword will the Lord plead with all flesh. And the slain of the Lord.
And the slain of the Lord, the killed of the Lord.
Shall be many.
Shall be many. Was that it?
Yes, sir.
All right, let's go on back to Isaiah 63:3 again.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 63 and verse 3. I have trodden the winepress alone, and of the people there was none with me. For I will tread them in mine anger, and trample them in my fury. And their blood
shall... And their blood, that's breaking down what that them grapes symbolize. And their blood...
And their blood shall be sprinkled upon my garments, and I will stain all my raiment.
Why?
For the day of vengeance is in mine heart, and the year of my redeemed is come.
That's it. Let's go on back. Where was we at initially? Jeremiah what?
Jeremiah chapter 25. And verse 30.
Go ahead.
The book of Jeremiah, chapter 25 and verse 30. Therefore, prophesy thou against them all these words, and say unto them, the Lord shall roar from on high, and utter his voice from his holy habitation. He shall mightily roar upon this habitation. He shall give a shout as they that tread the grapes against all the inhabitants of the earth.
That's right. That's he's going to do a whole lot of killing. Go ahead.
A noise shall come even to the ends of the earth. For the Lord hath a controversy with the nations.
Right, because they destroyed his people. Go ahead.
He will plead with all flesh. He will give them that are wicked to the sword, saith the Lord.
And that's all those nations we just listed, that God just listed. Go ahead.
Thus saith the Lord of hosts, behold, evil shall go forth from nation to nation, and a great whirlwind shall be raised up from the coast of the earth.
So that's why it said the nations will be mad, because we're prophesying evil from nation to nation to nation. Go ahead.
And the slain of the Lord shall be at that day from one end of the earth even unto the other end of the earth.
You know how much killing I can't? We cannot imagine how much dead bodies that is. Go ahead.
They shall not.
Hold it. That verse that you just read about the evil, go back to that for a second. I got tempted. I'm sorry. The verse that you just read before that.
Yes. Verse 33. And the slain of the Lord shall be at that day from one end of the earth even unto the other end of the earth.
That's the evil that's going to happen. Now, the book, where's that scripture that says, shall there be evil in a city?
Amos.
Amos. Read that one.
Yes, sir.
So how far this goes, because first the word gonna go out, then the death gonna go out.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Amos,
the book of Amos, chapter 3 and verse 6. Shall a trumpet be blown in the city?
The trumpet is this cup that we're bringing out, the Bible, the prophecies and the judgment that we're reading about. Read.
And the people be not afraid.
All of the nations going to be mad. That's what you're bringing out, Bishop. They're not going to want to hear any of this. Moab, nobody going to want to deal with this. Go ahead.
Shall there be evil in a city?
That's the evil that I was talking about earlier. Shall there be evil in Moab? Shall there be evil in Bozrah? Shall there be evil everywhere? In Ammon? All that. Go ahead.
And the Lord hath not done it.
And the Lord didn't do it. Now listen to this part. Go ahead.
Surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secret unto his servants, the prophets.
The prophets are pouring this cup on all the nations, and they don't want to hear about it.
Nobody want to hear that. Where we at in Jeremiah 25?
Yes, sir. Jeremiah chapter 25 and verse 33. And the slain of the Lord shall be at that day from one end of the earth even unto the other end of the earth. They shall not be lamented.
Ain't nobody going to cry for them. Go ahead.
Neither gathered nor buried. Mm. they shall be dung upon the ground.
Give me 2 Ezra 16. And one.
The book of 2 Esdras, chapter 16 and verse 1. Woe be unto thee, Babylon and Asia. Woe be unto thee, Egypt and Syria.
Now, I'm reading because I wanted to focus on Asia, because that's where China and Japan is located also. But read on. We're just going to read down.
Gird up yourselves with cloths of sack and hair. Bewail your children and be sorry, for your destruction is at hand. A sword is sent upon you, and who may turn it back? A fire is sent among you, and who may quench it? Plagues are sent unto you, and what is he that may drive them away? May any man drive away an hungry lion in the wood? Or may one quench the fire in the stubble?
Hey, look at 2 Ezra 15:46.
2 Ezra?
So I mentioned Asia, yeah.
The book of 2 Ezra. Chapter 15 and verse 46.
Mm-hmm.
And thou, Asia, that art partaker of the hope of Babylon and art the glory of her person.
So Moab and Ammon, China and Japan are the glory of Babylon. Go ahead.
Art the glory of her person. Woe be unto thee, thou wretch, because thou hast made thyself like unto her.
These two nations always wanted to be like America. Read.
And has decked thy daughters in whoredom.
Mm-hmm. Talking about their corporations, good.
That they might please and glory in thy lovers,
mm-hmm.
which have always desired to commit whoredom with thee.
So this whoredom is not talking about sex at all. It's talking about policies. It's talking about business practices. Good.
Thou hast followed her that is hated in all her works and inventions.
That's the evidence right there. Thou hast followed her, Babylon, that is hated in all her works and inventions. Whatever America invents, China wants it, Japan wants it too. Go ahead.
Therefore, saith God, I will send plagues upon thee, widowhood, poverty, famine, sword, and pestilence to waste thy houses with destruction and death.
That's where you want to now go back to 2 Ezra 16 and 1.
2 Ezra, chapter 16 and verse 1. Woe be unto thee, Babylon and Asia. Woe be unto thee, Egypt and Syria.
Come on.
Gird up yourselves with cloth and sack of, with cloths of sack of sack and hair. Sorry. Gird up yourselves with cloths of sack and hair. Bewail your children and be sorry.
Bewail your children and be sorry. Good.
For your destruction is at hand.
Your destruction is at hand. Come on.
A sword is sent upon you. And who may turn it back?
Who going to turn back to this judgment of God? Good.
A fire is set among you, and who may quench it? Plagues are sent unto you, and what is he that may drive them away? May any man drive away an hungry lion in the wood?
If you see a lion that ate in 4 days, he see you. You think you're going to stop him from eating you? There's nothing you can do. Good.
Or may anyone quench the fire in stubble when it hath begun to burn?
Read.
May one turn again the arrow that is shot of a strong archer.
If a strong man shoot an arrow at you, you ain't going to stop it. Good.
The mighty Lord sendeth the plague.
And it's the Lord that sends these plagues. Good.
And who is he that can drive them away?
Nobody. Good.
A fire shall go forth from his wrath. And who is he that may quench it?
Come on.
He shall cast lightnings, and who shall not fear?
Mm.
He shall thunder, and who shall not be afraid?
That's right. Come on.
The Lord shall threaten. And who shall not be utterly beaten to powder at his presence?
Read.
The earthquake and the foundations thereof. The sea ariseth up with waves from the deep, and the waves of it are troubled, and the fishes thereof also. Behold, the Lord.
Before the Lord.
Before the Lord, and before the glory of his power.
That's right. Come on.
For strong is his right hand that bendeth the bow. His arrows that he shooteth are sharp. Shall not miss.
The Lord, when the Lord shoot, he don't miss, God.
When they begin to be shot into the ends of the world.
Into the ends of, didn't he say there's going to be death from one side of the earth to the other?
Yes, sir.
That's that evil, God.
Behold, the plagues are sent and shall not return again until they come upon the earth. The fire is kindled and shall not be put out till it consume the foundation of the earth. Like as an arrow which is shot of a mighty archer returneth not backward, Even so, the plagues that shall be sent upon earth shall not return again.
Watch this.
Woe is me. Woe is me. Who will deliver me in those days?
Stop. Who will deliver me in those days? What is Ezra saying? That he's going to be here in these last days. That's what Ezra is saying. So he saw so much death, so much killing. He himself was terrified. He said, who will deliver me? Now, he ain't the only one that got terrified of stuff like that. Look at Revelation 10. I'm going to go with John first. 10, 9 to 11. Revelation 10.
The book of Revelation, chapter 10 and verse 9. And I went unto the angel and said unto him, give me the little book.
Give me the Bible. That's the little book. Go ahead.
And he said unto me, take it and eat it up, and it shall make thy
belly.
When
he said eat it up, he means study it. Read.
Take it and eat it up, and it shall make thy belly bitter, but it shall be in thy mouth sweet as honey.
It's sweet as honey in your mouth. We the Israelites, we're going to rule the world, and we all happy. But it's bitter in the belly because there's death, destruction. Some is death and destruction going to include your mama, your daddy, your children, and maybe you. That's that bitter in the belly. Go ahead.
And I took the little book out of the angel's hand and ate it up. And it was in my mouth sweet as honey. And as soon as I had eaten it, my belly was bitter.
Y'all see that? His belly was bitter. Now, Ezekiel 2 and 8. Oh, read the next verse. Read the next verse. I'm sorry. You're right.
Yes, sir. And he said unto me, thou must prophesy again before many peoples and nations and tongues and kings.
So what is he telling you about the Apostle John? He's back in his last days. Let's go back. Let's go to Ezekiel 2 and 8.
The book of Ezekiel. Oops. The book of Ezekiel. Chapter 2 and verse 8.
Here it come.
But thou, son of man, hear what I say unto thee. Be not thou rebellious like that rebellious house.
Israel, don't be like Israel. Go ahead.
Open thy mouth and eat that I give thee.
Open your mouth and learn what I'm giving you. Learn this Bible. Go ahead.
And when I looked, behold, a hand was sent unto me, and lo, a roll of a book was therein. And he spread it before me, and it was written. I'm sorry. And he spread it before me, and it was written within and without. And there was written therein lamentations and mourning and woe.
You see what he had to learn? He learned lamentations and mourning and woe, meaning destruction and death. That's what he learned. They don't learn about that in church. The church has cleverly, craftily found every love precept they can find and just highlight that. Love, love, love. And the rest of the 98% of the Bible, they ignore. You can't make this stuff up. Give me Daniel 7:28.
The book of Daniel, chapter 7, and verse 28. Hitherto is the end of the matter.
So, when you read the book of Daniel chapter 7, God describes his whole plan of what is going to happen. Read the verse above it, verse 27.
Daniel chapter 7, verse 27. And the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kingdom of under the whole heaven.
Wait. Let me see. Start at 26.
But the judgment shall sit, and they shall take away his dominion.
They shall take away the white man's dominion. Go ahead.
To consume, and to destroy it unto the end.
And destroy it unto the end. The white man's rulership will be destroyed in the end of the world. Read.
And the kingdom and dominion.
And the kingdom and dominion.
And the greatness of the kingdoms under the whole heaven.
That means the whole planet earth.
Shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High.
Read.
Whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom.
So everything's going to be given to the Israelites. That's what it means to the people of the saints of the Most High, whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. Go ahead.
And all dominions shall serve and obey him.
Everybody's going to obey our king, Christ, the king. Ever understand that? Read.
Hitherto is the end of the matter.
Meaning that's what the entire Bible is about. That's what God's plan is about. Read.
As for me, Daniel. My cogitation.
My cogitation, that means my thoughts. Go ahead.
much troubled me.
My thoughts troubled me. Why? Because he saw so much death and destruction. When you read Daniel 7, it's not nice. It goes, when you get to verse 27, that's when we get the kingdom. But before that is death, destruction, death, destruction, death, destruction. Read it again.
And hitherto is the end of the matter. As for me, Daniel, my cogitations much troubled me, and my countenance changed in me. But I kept the matter in my heart.
So he was troubled when he saw all that he saw. So it wasn't an old happy day. He was like, what the hell? What did I just see? Death from one end of the earth to the other end. Hey, find me that one in Amos. It just popped in my head. It's a day of darkness. Who knows what that is? Amos 5, you said?
Yeah.
Let me see. Where is it? It says, day of the Lord is darkness and not light.
Yes, sir. The book of Amos. Chapter 5 and verse 18.
Yes, sir.
Woe unto you that desire the day of the Lord. To what end is it for you? For the day of the Lord is darkness and not light.
The day of the Lord is darkness and not light. Go ahead.
Shall
As if
a man did flee from a lion and a bear.
So you running from a lion. You see a hungry lion. You running. You run around the corner. And you are, I'm scared, I got out of that lion's way. Then what happens, Reed?
And a bear met him.
God daggone it, there's a bear. Now comes a freaking bear. And you run, Reed.
Or went into the house.
And you ran into the house to get away from the freaking bear. Go ahead.
And leaned his hand on the wall.
Whoa, got away from that bear too. Go ahead.
And a serpent bit him.
And now you got bit by a snake. What the, there's no escape from God's words. Go ahead.
So shall not the day of the Lord be darkness and not light? Even very dark and no brightness in it.
There's no brightness in it. So from there, give me Habakkuk 3:16. Habakkuk.
Hey, Bishop, so yes, I can't go live off grid. I ain't going to be good off grid.
Off grid, you ain't going to be good. You ain't good. No, you can run to Jamaica or Haiti. You ain't going to be good. No matter where you go, you ain't going to be good. And you know why it's such a terrible thing? He said it's a day of what? Woe unto you that desire the day of the Lord. Because a lot of times brothers, especially sisters, think, I know I'm going to be saved. Oh, really? Really? You got to go through a whole lot of stuff? And didn't you just suck? I mean, didn't you just commit adultery last night?
Damn.
Wasn't you just doing, contacting your ex-man and your husband was sleeping in bed next to you? Right. But she's so, I'm going to be saved by the Lord. Jesus. Yeah, okay. Ask them go Christian women. Where we at?
Habakkuk chapter 3 and verse 16. When I heard, my belly trembled.
Wait a minute. You heard what Habakkuk said? Read the verse above it.
It's verse 15. Thou didst walk through the sea with thine horses.
The Lord walked through the nations with his chariots. Go ahead.
Through the heap of great waters.
Through the heap of great waters. Go ahead.
When I heard, my belly trembled.
When I heard, my belly trembled. Go ahead.
My lips quivered at the voice.
You see that? My lips quivered at the voice. Go ahead.
Rottenness entered into my bones.
That's how much terrified he was. So what makes you think we're going to be all happy? Here come the Lord. No. No.
You got to dramatize with it. Just
go ahead, dramatize it for me.
Read it again.
When I heard, my belly trembled.
The verse before that.
Thou didst walk through the sea with thine horses.
So the Most High, this is the wine press. When he walked through these nations, he's going to be crushing bones, skulls going to get smashed, vertebrae is going to get crushed, blood going to be sputing out their eyes and all that because the pressure going to push it out. Read.
Through the heap of great waters.
Through the heap of great nations. You read in Revelation where the waters are great, what it said, nations, tongues, and all that. Read.
When I heard, my belly trembled.
When I heard, my belly trembled. Listen.
My lips quivered at the voice.
At the voice. What was the voice? Yea, he shall cry, yea, roar, and he shall prevail against his enemies. All that crying is the Most High is going, Christ going to be doing when he come down and be screaming while he's killing. So he's going to see, hear bones cracking, ribs getting smashed, heads getting split open, blood all over the place,
and Christ screaming while he's killing them.
Hey, that's why Ezra said, who will deliver me in those days? As righteous as we see Ezra is, he himself knows, I'm not all that. I got some stuff in me. I might not make it. Right. Read that again.
When I heard, my belly trembled. My lips quivered at the voice. Rottenness entered into my bones, and I trembled in myself, that I might rest in the day of trouble.
Y'all know what that means, that I might rest in the day of trouble? He said, I wish I was dead. I want to be at rest with the Lord. I don't want to be on the earth when this goes down. Go ahead.
When he cometh up unto the people.
When Christ comes up unto the people.
He will invade them with his troops.
There will be an invasion on this planet Earth. There will be. That's what Space Force X is all about, to prevent it. That's what it is. From there. Give me 2 Ezra 1:35. Yeah, that was good, Bishop. That was good. Bones crushing and vertebrae and all that stuff. And the eyes popping out. Yeah. 2 Ezra 1. I like reading 2 Ezra 1 when the prophets, I just love it. Read it again.
The book of 2 Ezra, chapter 1 and verse 35. Your houses will I give to a people that shall come.
So Jerusalem was destroyed. The people that's to come is us. We're the people that is for to come. Got it?
Which not having heard of me, yet shall believe me.
We never heard of a black Messiah, a king. This is all new to us. This is why people say, oh, that's a new religion y'all teaching. That's new. That's why in Psalms 131, Psalms 149, it says, sing unto the Lord a what?
New song.
A new song. Read.
Your houses will I give to a people that shall come, mm-hmm. which not having heard of me, yet shall believe me, to whom I have showed no sign.
We saw no signs. Go ahead.
Yet. They shall do that I have commanded.
So
them.
Those of you online, wait, I need to see a sign from the Lord. You ain't gonna see no sign. Read it again so they can hear.
To whom I have showed no signs.
To whom I have showed no signs. Yet what?
Yet they shall do that I have commanded them.
That's us. We've seen no signs from the Lord, but we believe what he's commanded. Go ahead.
They have seen no prophets.
We didn't see Moses. We haven't seen Ezra. We have not seen them in the flesh. We don't even know who each other is. We don't know. We have not seen them. Go ahead.
Yet they shall call their sins to remembrance.
Yet we call our sins to remembrance. Our sins and the sins of our forefathers. Go ahead.
And acknowledge them.
And we acknowledge our sins. Go ahead.
I take to witness the grace of the people to come.
Mm-hmm.
Whose little ones rejoice in gladness.
And our children growing up in the truth. And it's a shame for you men and women online. You know your sons and daughters rejoice in this word. Then you decide, I'm going to be a Christian again. Or you want to suck rod again. And you take them kids back out into the world and have a miserable life. Shame on you. What verse you at?
37.
Go ahead.
I take to witness the grace of the people to come. Whose little ones rejoice in gladness.
Haven't you seen that? The kids rejoice in high holy days, rejoice in seeing, they can't wait to see each other.
Yep. You got to understand, I hope y'all trying to glean what Bishop's trying to explain, especially those that have family. Your poor decision making because you don't want to serve God. Your kids that's coming up in this all they know. This all they know. So the day you decide to depart from this and you sit home, I always imagine that first Sabbath when you're not here
right. And
you sit down with your kids and you're trying to go through the scriptures with them and you think you explaining some precepts, then comes the second Sabbath and the third Sabbath. Do you understand what's happening? You pull from underneath them everything they know and for your wife, all the relationships they have because you would not submit to the word of God. Give it a few months in, y'all celebrating Christmas.
That's right. Exactly. And not only, it might not be that they want to go back into Christianity. She decides she want another man. He decides he want another woman. And they back out and drag the family back out in the world again. And your kids are miserable. And you see the degradation, the degeneracy of your kids, the various stages they go through. Where we at? I'm sorry.
Hold one second. How many of those that have been around have seen that? You've seen some of these families. Next thing you know, you run to them in Walmart. The girls got pants on. The man, is his bed is off his faith, and they still think they're serving God. Man, you're delusional.
Where we at?
Verse 37.
Go ahead.
I take to witness the grace of the people to come, whose little ones rejoice in gladness. And though they have not seen me with bodily eyes, yet in spirit they believe the thing that I say.
We have not seen the Lord with bodily eyes, yet we believe the things that's written in this Bible. Go ahead.
And now, brother, behold what glory, and see the people that cometh from the east, mm-hmm. unto whom I will give for leaders Abraham.
Abraham's back.
Isaac.
Isaac's back.
And Jacob.
Jacob's back.
Oseas.
Hosea's back.
Amos.
Amos is back.
Micaiah.
Micah is back.
Joel.
Joel is back.
Abdias.
Obadiah is back.
And Jonas.
Jonah is back.
Nahum.
Nahum is back.
Habakkuk.
Habakkuk is back.
Zephaniah.
Zephaniah is back.
Agagus.
Haggai is back.
Zachary.
Zechariah is back.
Malachi.
And Malachi is back.
Which is called also an angel of the Lord.
Now, from there, chapter 2, verse 18.
The book of Second Esdras, chapter 2 and verse 18.
Where we at? Okay, go ahead.
Second Esdras, chapter 2 and verse 18. For thy help will I send my servants, Esau,
Isaiah,
and Jeremy.
Jeremiah.
After whose counsel I have sanctified and prepared thee 12 trees laden with diverse fruits.
Now y'all see that part, 12 trees laden with diverse fruits. That's the 12 apostles. Now from there, watch, I'm going to show you. Give me Psalms 1, these 12 trees. 12 trees. I didn't talk about 12 trees. I don't understand. Is it a red cedar tree? Is it an apple tree, an orange tree? Let's see what the tree is. Psalms 1. Start at 1.
The book of Psalms, chapter 1 and verse 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly.
Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of wicked Negroes. Go ahead.
Nor standeth in the way of sinners.
Read.
Nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord.
So, brothers, our delight, sisters, must be in the law of the Lord. Go ahead.
And in his law doth he meditate day and night.
In his law, meditate day and night. Come on.
And he shall be like a tree.
He shall be like what?
A tree.
He shall be like what?
A tree.
One more again.
Tree.
He shall be like a tree.
Planted by the rivers of water.
Remember, it said there shall be 12 trees. Go ahead.
That bringeth forth fruit. That bringeth forth his fruit in his season.
That bringeth forth his fruit in his season. Meaning understanding in his season. Like Passover, for example, comes in a spring season. Hanukkah comes in a winter season. Everybody understand that?
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
His leaf also shall not wither.
His understanding will not wither.
And whatsoever he doeth shall prosper.
Whatsoever he does shall prosper. Go ahead.
The ungodly are not so.
The ungodly ain't so.
But are like the chaff which the wind driveth away.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgments, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous.
Read.
For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish.
So we went here to show you that these trees that keep the commandments, these men that keep the commandments are like trees by the rivers. Everybody understand that?
Yes, sir.
So now, watch this. Let's go on back. Let's go to Revelation 22:1. Watch this.
The book of Revelation, chapter 22 and verse 1. And he showed me a pure river of water of life.
He showed me a pure river of water of life.
Clear as crystal.
Clear as crystal.
Proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb.
Write this down. This river, give me Ephesians 5:26. You know what I want?
Yes, sir. The book of Ephesians, chapter 5 and verse 26. That he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word.
Washing of water by the word. So the water is symbolic of what? The word. Go back to Revelation 22.
The book of Revelation, chapter 22 and verse 1. And he showed me a pure river of water of life.
That's the word of God. That's the scriptures. Good.
Clear as crystal.
Uh-huh.
Proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb.
Read.
In the midst of the street of it, And on either side of the river was there the tree of life,
uh-huh.
which bare 12 manner of fruits.
Which bare 12 manner of fruits. Go ahead.
And yielded her fruit every month.
Every month there's laws coming out. Every month. You got Sabbath, New Moon. You know those two come every month, right or wrong?
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations.
And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. Watch this. Give me Ezekiel 47. Ezekiel 47. And 1.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 47 and verse 1. Afterward, he brought me again unto the door of the house, and behold, waters issued out from under the threshold of the house.
Guess what this is talking about? The same thing we just read in Revelation 22. It's the same thing. Read it again.
Afterward, he brought me again unto the door of the house. And behold, waters issued out from under the threshold of the house eastward. For the forefront of the house stood toward the east. And the waters came down from under the right side of the house and the south side of the altar. Then brought he me out of the way of the gate northward, and led me about the way without unto the utter gate by the way that looketh eastward. And behold, there ran out waters on the right side.
Mm-hmm.
And when the man that had the line in his hand went forth eastward, he measured 1,000 cubits.
He measured 1,000 cubits of this water. Go ahead.
And he brought me through the waters. The waters were to the ankles.
So the waters represent what, brothers? The word. So their understanding was only up to the ankles. So we can't, what we know today, we can't judge our foreparents from the past and say, oh, they're going to get A, B, or C. They didn't have the understanding we got. They got it up to the ankles, okay? So they're going to be judged on the understanding they were given at that time. Everybody understand that?
Yes, sir.
Read that part again.
And he brought me through the waters. The waters were to the ankles.
Read.
Again, he measured 1,000. And brought me through the waters. The waters were to the knees.
Now he looks, they measured again. Now this time, this is going up in time, in time. Now the understanding comes up to the knees. So the group that was at the ankles ain't going to be judged the same way as the group at the knees. Everybody understand that?
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
Again, he measured 1,000 and brought me through. The waters were to the loins.
Now the loins is at the waist area. Now we got more. This is still time and understanding. As time goes on, we're drawing closer to the Lord. The understanding is increasing. Everybody understand that?
Yes, sir.
So anybody that says our understanding is the same as it was back in 1969, that's a group of idiots. They don't know the scriptures at all. You better run the hell out of there. Go ahead.
Afterward, he measured 1,000. And it was a river that I could not pass over.
After that, he said it was so much understanding, he said you can't pass it. Go ahead.
For the waters were risen, waters to swim in, a river that could not be passed over.
You couldn't pass over this. Go ahead.
And he said unto me, Son of man, hast thou seen this? Then he brought me and caused me to return to the brink of the river. Now, when I had returned, behold, at the bank of the river were very many trees on the one side and on the other.
Didn't we just read that in Psalms 1? And what else did we read that? In a Second Esdras 2. Second Esdras 2. Read that again.
Now, when I had returned, behold, at the bank of the river were very many trees on the one side and on the other.
Because in Psalms 2, it said 12 trees. In Psalms 1, it gives you the analogy that the man that keeps the commandments is like a tree besides the rivers. Go ahead.
Then said he unto me, these waters issue out toward the east country and go down into the desert and go into the sea, which being brought forth into the sea, the waters shall be healed.
The water, the nations shall be healed. That's what it's talking. Give me Ezekiel 36, 35 real quick.
Yes, sir.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 36 and verse 35. And they shall say, this land that was desolate is become like the Garden of Eden. And the waste and desolate and ruined cities are become fenced and are inhabited.
That's right, read.
Then the heathen that are left round about you shall know that I, the Lord.
So everybody ain't going to get destroyed. It says the heathen that are left round about you. Go ahead.
Shall know that I, the Lord, build the ruined places and plant that was desolate. I, the Lord, have spoken it, and I will do it.
Let's go back. Verse 9.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 47 and verse 9. And it shall come to pass that everything that liveth, which moveth, whithersoever the river shall come.
Wherever the word of God shall come.
Shall live.
Do y'all see it? Wherever the word of God shall go, they shall live. Go ahead.
And there shall be a very great multitude of fish, mm-hmm. because these waters shall come thither. For they shall be healed, mm-hmm. and everything that shall live whither the river cometh. And it shall come to pass that the fishers shall stand upon the...
We're the fishers. Read again. We are the fishers. Go ahead.
And it shall come to pass that the fishers...
Read. Give me that Matthew 13, 47, I think it is.
Yes, sir. 47. The book of Matthew, chapter 13 and verse 47.
That ain't the one I want, but where's the one where Christ said, I will make you fishers of men? That one. Where is it? Matthew 4 and 19. Get that. Thank you.
The book of Matthew, chapter 4 and verse 19. And he saith unto them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men.
That's the one I want right there. That's it. So going back. In Ezekiel 47 and 10.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 47 and verse 10. And it shall come to pass that the fishers shall stand upon it from En-Gedi even unto
En-Eglaim.
En-Eglaim.
Mm-hmm.
They shall be a place to spread forth nets.
Now this goes into Matthew. Now go to Matthew 13, 47 about the nets. That's what I wanted. I knew I had it down there for a reason.
The book of Matthew, chapter 14 and verse 13 and 47. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a net that was cast into the sea and gathered of every kind,
mm-hmm.
which, when it was full, they drew to shore and sat down and gathered the good into vessels, but cast the bad away.
Now, let's go back to Ezekiel now. Verse 10, one more again.
Ezekiel, chapter 47 and verse 10. And it shall come to pass that the fishers shall stand upon it from En-Gedi even unto En-Eglaim. They shall be a place to spread forth nets. They shall fish all.
No, read it right.
Their fish shall be according to their kind.
Their fish shall be according to their kind. What does that mean? We're only fishing for Israelites.
That's right.
We're not fishing for Ammonites or Philistines or Edomites. Everybody understand that? Go ahead.
As the fish of the great sea exceeding
many. There's going to be a whole lot of us. Go ahead.
But the miry places
but
thereof.
But the miry places thereof.
And the marshes thereof.
And the marshes thereof.
Shall not be healed.
Shall not be healed.
They shall be given to salt.
They shall be given to salt. That's these rebellious ones. Give me that Jeremiah 17, 5 and 6. So not only is that the nations, but any of our people that want to follow the nations. Jeremiah 17, 5 and 6.
The book of Jeremiah, chapter 17 and verse 5. Thus saith the Lord, cursed be the man that trusteth in man and maketh flesh his arm, and whose heart departeth from the Lord. For he shall be like the heath in the desert, and shall not see when good cometh, but shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness, in a salt land, and not inhabit.
Right, because they're going to get jacked up. Just like in Zechariah, where it says, if Egypt don't obey, they shall have no rain in their land. Everybody familiar with that, right? Let's go back.
Ezekiel, chapter 47. In verse 11,
mm-hmm.
but the miry places thereof and the marshes thereof shall not be healed. They shall be given to salt, and by the river upon the bank thereof, on this side and on that side, shall grow all trees for meat.
Shall grow all trees for meat, for food, for understanding is talking about. Go ahead.
Whose leaf shall not fade.
That's what Psalm chapter 1 is all about. Whose leaf shall not fade. Go ahead.
Neither shall the fruit thereof be consumed.
It ain't going to be destroyed. Go ahead.
It shall bring forth new fruit according to his month.
Y'all see that? That's the proof. It shall bring forth new fruit according to his month. Give me that Isaiah 66, 23, I think, about from one Sabbath to the next.
Yes, sir. The book of Isaiah, chapter 66 and verse 23. And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Sabbath to another, shall all flesh come to worship before me, saith the Lord.
Go back, Ezekiel 47 again, verse 12, one more time.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 47 and verse 12. And by the river upon the bank thereof, and on this side and on that side, shall grow all trees for meat.
That's the Israelites, go ahead.
Whose leaf shall not fade.
The leaders of Israel, go ahead.
Neither shall the fruit thereof be consumed. It shall bring forth new fruit according to his months. Because their waters they issued out of the sanctuary. And the fruit thereof shall be for meat, and the leaf thereof for medicine.
Because if you obey the medicine, which is God's word, you're going to be okay. But if you rebel, then it's going to be death and destruction on you. Isaiah 2. We're almost done. Isaiah 2. And start at 1.
The book of Isaiah.
I'm still showing you the correlation. Go ahead.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 2 and verse 1.
Mm-hmm.
The word that Isaiah, the son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. And it shall come to pass in the last days.
In the last days.
That the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established in the top of the mountain.
Because our kingdom's going to be at the top of the mountains. Go ahead.
And shall be exalted above the hill.
And our kingdom's going to be exalted above all the hills. Go ahead.
And all nations shall flow unto it.
And that starts with us first. Go ahead.
And many people shall go and say, come ye, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. And he will teach us of his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem.
That's what we read in Ezekiel 47. That's what we read in Revelation 22. Everybody see that?
Yes, sir.
The law going forth is the same thing. What verse was that?
That was verse 3.
Read on.
And he shall judge among the nations, and shall rebuke many people. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears unto pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore.
So the only time there's going to be world peace is when the 12 tribes of Israel are in power. That's everybody right. Understand that? Yes. That is the only time there's going to be world peace, when we subdue all nations. Go ahead.
O house of Jacob, come ye, and let us walk in the light of the Lord. Therefore, thou hast forsaken thy people, the house of Jacob.
Because that's all I wanted. From there, Matthew 19, 28. Now, Matthew 19, 28 goes with, remember in 2 Ezra chapter 2, it said there shall be 12 trees laden with fruit. Everybody familiar with that, what we read earlier, right?
Yes, sir.
Matthew 19, 28.
The book of Matthew, chapter 19 and verse 28. And Jesus said unto them, verily I say unto you, that ye which have followed me in the regeneration, when the Son of Man shall sit in the throne of his glory, ye shall also sit upon 12 thrones.
You shall also sit upon 12 thrones, good.
Judging the 12 tribes of Israel.
Judging the 12 tribes of Israel. 2 Ezra 16, 37.
The book of 2 Ezra.
Yep, chapter 16, verse 37.
Chapter 16 and verse 37.
Mm-hmm.
Behold, the plagues draw nigh and are not slack. As when a woman with child in the ninth month bringeth forth her son, within 2 or 3 hours of her birth, great pains compass her womb.
So the Lord is comparing the plagues that he's sending upon the earth to a woman in childbirth. And he says, read it again.
As when a woman with child in the ninth month bringeth forth her son, within 2 or 3 hours
of... Stop. So those 2 or 3 hours symbolize either 2 or 3 years down to 2 and 3 months to 2 and 3 weeks to 2 and 3 days. Read it again.
As when a woman with
child... Start at 37 again, 37.
Behold, the plagues draw nigh and are not slack. As when a woman with child in the ninth month bringeth forth her son, within 2 or 3 hours of her birth, great pains compass her womb. Which pains, when the child cometh forth, they slack not a moment.
Mm-hmm, okay.
Even so shall not the plagues be slack to come upon the earth, and the world shall mourn, and sorrow shall come upon it on every side.
So that's what Amos was saying. It's a day of darkness and not light. Go ahead.
O my people, hear my words. Make you ready to the battle, and in those evils be even as pilgrims upon the earth.
This is why the Apostle Paul says, as good soldiers. Why? Remember, it says right here, oh, my children, make you ready to the battle. Give me that in Timothy chapter 2, like 3 and 4, something like that.
Second, let's see. Yes, sir. The book of Second Timothy.
Mm-hmm.
Chapter 2 and verse 3.
4 and 4. Yes, 3 sir. And 4. Mm-hmm.
Thou, therefore, endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ.
That's why Ezra said, oh, my children, make you ready to the battle. Prepare your soul. Prepare your spirits. Go ahead.
No man that warreth entangleth himself.
Notice that no man that warreth. That's that battle. Make you ready to the battle. Read again verse 4.
No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life.
Don't get caught up in this world's political ventures and you all arguing about wedding anniversaries and stupidity like that. Don't get caught up in this world's affairs. Read again.
No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life,
mm-hmm.
that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier.
Brother, who called y'all to be a soldier?
Christ.
You sure it wasn't your wife? The Lord called you. You home arguing with the wife. You missed some stupid anniversary, and now she want a divorce. And you all upset. What you upset? Let the hoe go. Let her go. Bye. Arguing, fussing, and fighting about Valentine's. She want to fight about Valentine's Day. A day of fornication. To hell with that. Don't get entangled in the affairs of this life. Baby shower gender. Who gonna eat the pink sperm, the blue sperm? The hell is this? The hell is this? You can't make that stuff up. Going back to where we was at.
Second Idris chapter.
Where we at?
Second Idris 15 and 40.
Yeah, read it 40 again.
The book of 2 Esdras, chapter 16 and verse 40. O my people, hear my words. Make ye ready to the battle.
See that? Make you ready to the battle. Go ahead.
And in those evils, be even as pilgrims upon the earth.
Be ready to up and leave. Be ready to up and go. Jump down to verse 63.
Verse 63.
Start at 62.
Yea. And the Spirit of Almighty God, which made all things and searcheth out all hidden things and the secrets of the earth. Surely he knoweth your inventions and what ye think in your hearts, even them that sin and would hide their sin.
A lot of times we sin and we think we can hide it. Nobody knows. Nobody knows what I did last night. I got away with it. Nobody, brothers, sisters, nobody gets away. Nobody. The Lord is a chess player. He'll set you up. He'll have your adultery come out through a baby. You fornicating on the phone and the baby find the phone and throw the phone behind the toilet. Right. And the phone is ringing and everybody's trying to find the phone. Then the wrong person find the phone. How'd this come out? The baby found it. That's the Lord. The Lord does that stuff. It's a horrible chain of events. Remember, the woman got her house. She's committing adultery. The black ninja broke through the window, rolled on the floor, grabbed the cell phone,
hit the button
to send all her texts, and it went to everybody and just happened to go to brothers in Atlanta. And meanwhile, that sister and brother, they were so holy. Are y'all committing adultery? Y'all dealing? No, never. So what are these text messages? Oh! That's the Lord. Read it again.
Surely he knoweth your inventions and what ye think in your hearts, even them that sin and would hide their sin.
Even them that sin and would hide their sin. You think you're going someplace late at night, and all of a sudden here comes a brother or sister from the congregation, just happened to come from the grocery store, and he happened to see you with somebody not your spouse, holding hands. Yeah. Now, read on.
Therefore hath the Lord exactly searched out all your works, and he will put you all to shame.
He will put you all to shame. Read it again.
Therefore hath the Lord exactly searched out all your works, and he will put you all to shame.
He'll put you to shame. Come on.
And when your sins are brought forth.
And when your sins are brought forth.
Ye shall be ashamed before men.
Mm.
And your own sins.
And your own sins.
Shall be your accusers in that day.
What you mad at us for? Bruh, stop, sis, stop. What you mad at us for? This is you. This is you. You did this. You created this whole situation. You stood here and lied. Why are you mad at us? Go ahead.
What
they do. They get mad at us like we did something to them. Said no, yeah, we become their enemies. We didn't do that.
Yeah, I want to say, and even, I'm telling you, when it says hide your sin, say nobody ever finds out. We all will answer what we do in this body. It's not, we don't get away with it. There will be a day of reckoning with the Lord. He's not going to let us just, because man doesn't see. Every sin that we do in this body, we will answer for it. Hope you all understand that. If not today, one day.
Just like the football player brother, the tall brother, the handsome brother that all the sisters went goo-goo gaga over. And the sister say, Bishop, I want that brother right there. So you want that brother right there? Bruh, that sister right there want to talk to you. I don't want her. I'm not interested in no woman. Next sister come, bruh, Bishop, I want that brother right there. That same brother right there. I want that brother right there. Bruh, she wants you right there. I don't want her. I'm for the Lord. All of his might.
Bishop, I thought he was so deep. I said, surely God is dealing with him.
Yep.
Get to find out.
No.
Get to find out. He like you. Someone like you. Someone like you, not you.
That's you.
I gotta go to the bathroom.
You gotta go to the bathroom? You got gas now. But these are the things that occurs. Read that again.
And when your sins are brought forth, ye shall be ashamed before men. And your own sins shall be your accusers in that day.
What you mad at us for? What you mad for? We didn't do nothing to you. The next brother, his wife steals $31,000 from his bank account. And we said, bro, she's leaving you. Yeah. No, she ain't leaving me. Bro, she's leaving you. No. There's a good explanation why she took that money without asking me. There's no good explanation, brother. No. $31,000? No. That is a plan, a well-calculated plan. Sure enough, she up and leaves. But I said to her in the council, you're dealing with another man, aren't you? She said, oh, no, Bishop. I don't know what you're thinking. I said, you're dealing with another man. Yes, you is. She said, no, I'm not. And I resent the fact that you brought that up. And furthermore, the way you men break down the scriptures about, what is about God calls a woman a dog. What scripture is that? How does it go? A dog. How does it go?
26, a shameless.
A wicked woman, a shameless woman shall be counted as a dog. She said, I don't appreciate y'all saying B-I-T-C-H. Just say dog. Why don't you say that? Why does that offend you when brothers say B-I-T? Why does it make you so mad? Because, I said, it's because you're dealing with another man. Stop saying I'm not dealing with another man. 2 weeks go by, she's dealing with another man. And the brother's mad at us and is on YouTube now cursing us out like we did him some wrong, some great evil. You can't make this stuff up. Where we at? I'm sorry.
Verse 65.
Go ahead.
And when your sins are brought forth, ye shall be ashamed before men, and your own sins shall be your accusers in that day.
That's right. Go ahead.
What will ye do?
What will you do? Go ahead.
Or how will ye hide your sins before God and his angels?
That's what Bishop Kanai was saying. What can we do to you? All we can say is get out. But when God and the angels get involved, now that's something different. Go ahead.
Behold, God himself is the judge.
I wonder why he got hit by that car. I wonder why she got stabbed. How come when that bullet missed everybody but her? Mm-hmm. Go ahead, read it again.
Behold, God himself is the judge. Fear him.
You fearing us. I don't want the leadership to know. We ain't nobody. Hey, call us what you call us when you mad at night. Niggas. You're a bunch of niggas up there. All right, then that's who we are then. A group of niggas. Read it again.
Behold, God himself is the judge. Fear him.
That's who you better fear. Go ahead.
Leave off from your sins and forget not your iniquities.
And and forget.
Oh, I'm sorry. Behold, God himself is the judge.
Was that a Freudian slip? Go ahead.
Behold, God himself is the judge. Fear him. Leave off from your sins and forget your iniquities to meddle no more with them forever.
You know what they're saying, brothers? You know what they're saying? Stop watching porn. Stop watching porn. Look at the heads go down now. I ain't looking at that scripture. What was scripture? Ooh, yeah, scriptures. I'm not looking over there. That nigga's going to call on me. He might just say something. Yeah, that's him right there. Read that one more again.
Behold, God himself is the judge. Fear him.
Mm-hmm.
Leave off from your sins and forget your iniquities to meddle no more with them forever.
To meddle no more with them forever. Go ahead.
So shall God lead you forth and deliver you from all trouble.
If you meddle no more with your sins, he said he'll deliver you from all trouble. I know, but we all go through trouble. I go through trouble. We want to be delivered from all trouble. But brothers, that's always in trouble after trouble after trouble. We know why you keep, things don't go right for you because you're meddling in your sin. You go for a job, you lose the job. And what, God, Jesus, Lord Jesus, I can't get a job. Because you're meddling in your sin. You've been hiding it from us, but that's what it is. Read them.
Bishop, that goes back to your sin withhold that good things from you.
Yes.
You know, that's that scripture there.
Exactly. Go ahead.
For behold, the burning wrath of a great multitude is kindled over you.
Mm-hmm.
And they shall take away certain of you.
Yeah, Esau shall take away certain of us.
And feed you, being idle with things offered unto idols.
You know who that is that's idle? It goes back to verse 67 with those meddling in their sins. Go ahead.
And they that consent unto them shall be had in derision and in reproach and trodden underfoot.
Esau is going to use you against the gospel. He's going to use you against the truth. And when he finishes using you, he's going to destroy you. You see how that idiot, what's that little white boy's name, that little caucasoid vocab? After he uses you to come against this truth, he dumps you by the side of the road and says, don't talk to me no more. He don't need you no more. He just wanted your little stupid testimony. And now I say, hey, don't call me no more. You ain't nothing. Typical Esau. And y'all at home ain't figured that out. I'm calling vocab like you hurting someone. You ain't hurting us. It ain't stopping us. You the one that get humiliated at the end of the day.
That's right.
Remember the woman said, one woman said, if you don't do it, I'm going to call Sarnetta. I forgot what the situation was. Isaac, you remember?
No, sir. I don't remember the situation, but I remember the comment.
It's going to come back and say, anybody remember that situation? If you don't do it, say something. I got to think a second. Say something clever. Let me think.
Read that last verse.
And they that consent unto them shall be had in derision and in reproach. And trodden underfoot.
Read on.
For there shall be in every place.
Oh, no, I want to go up a little higher.
67.
Verse 67.
Behold, God himself is the judge. Fear him. Leave off from your sins and forget your iniquities to meddle no more with them forever. So shall God lead you forth and deliver you from all trouble.
Now watch this. Verse 77.
Woe be unto them that abound with their sin.
That's the one. Woe to them that are bound with their sins. Read on.
And covered with their iniquities, like as a field is covered over with bushes, and the path thereof covered with thorns, that no man may travel through.
That's because you entertain your sin so much that you cannot escape it. It's some people, that's what he was saying earlier, that you have problem after problem, trouble after trouble. It's because God is withholding something from you. You haven't figured it out. But guess what? Verse 75.
Be ye not afraid, neither doubt, for God is your guide.
Those are the ones that have stopped sinning, that has gotten itself together. God, you will not be afraid in that day. God is going to guide you, protect you. So for those of those that don't get it, well, then it just is what it is. No scriptures. You worrying about man.
Right.
That, I'm telling you, all we could do is just beat you down with precepts, mm-hmm. tell you that you're evil. That's nothing
right.
in comparison to what the Lord is going to do.
Exactly. You know, I still can't remember the story, but it's something a sister said. She wanted us, and Captain Joel said, we do not negotiate with terrorists. I'm just trying to remember what she said. She wanted us to do something, and it was evil as hell. I just can't remember. Watch, 3 a.m, bing, it'll pop. Back to 69. She online, hey, sister, if you're online watching, you wanted us to do something. You threatened us with Sarnetta, like we were supposed to get scared and terrified. Ooh, oh, God, Sarnetta. Ooh, vocab. Ooh! Where we at, bro?
Verse 69.
Go ahead.
And they that consent unto them shall be had in derision. And they that consent unto them shall be had in derision and in reproach and trodden underfoot.
That's right. Come on.
For there shall be in every place and in the next cities a great insurrection upon those that fear the Lord.
And this is what we have to prepare ourselves. This is the battle, the real battle we got to prepare ourselves for. Okay. First it's spiritual. Then it becomes physical. Read that again.
For there shall be in every place and in the next cities a great insurrection upon those that fear the Lord.
You got to pay attention. The ADL, SPLC, Canary Mission, APAC, they're making laws, creating legislation against what they call hate speech, which is deemed anything that goes against so-called Jewish people. If you say that they're not the Jews, that's deemed hate speech. See, the first thought when you hear hate speech, you think, oh, you're saying somebody wants to kill somebody. That's your first thought, but that's not in their meaning of their words, in their legislation. Just reading Revelation 2:9 and 3:9 is deemed hate speech. Y'all understand that?
Yes, sir.
Just speaking of Leviticus 18:22 about homosexuality, that's hate speech against homosexuality, lesbianism, LGBT community, that's hate speech. If you don't use their pronouns, that's hate speech. I'm sure, I'm telling you, read it again, verse 70.
For there shall be in every place and in the next cities a great insurrection upon those that fear the Lord.
This is saying the same thing that Revelation 12 and 17 says. Read Revelation 12. So we're coming back here, though. Read that again.
The book of Revelation, chapter 12 and verse 17.
Mm-hmm.
And the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war.
The white man was wroth with the Israelites. Go ahead.
And went to make war.
Remember, make you ready to the battle. Go ahead.
With the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ.
That war is physical. That war is physical. Because the verse above it, read the verse above it.
Verse 16. And the earth helped the woman.
Read the verse above that.
And the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood.
This is the spiritual. This is them bringing out doctrines and propaganda against us. Go ahead.
And the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood after the woman.
We're the Israelite women. Go ahead.
That he might cause her to be carried away of the flood.
They try to get us to be carried away with Christianity and all the other lies they put out there. Go ahead.
And the earth helped the woman.
The teachers. That's the teachers with the word of God. Go ahead.
And the earth opened her mouth
and
swallowed up the flood, which the dragon cast out of his mouth.
We use this Bible to swallow up all the lies that the serpent casts out of their media. The mouth of the serpent is their media. Go ahead.
And the dragon was wroth with the woman.
Uh-huh.
And went to make war.
Now goes the physical. It went from spiritual, just words, now physical. Go ahead.
And went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ.
Yes. Say what you're going to say.
That's telling you that the flood didn't work.
Right.
It said that she might be carried away. Read that verse again. The flood verse. Come on, real quick. I want to hold the bishop
verse
up.
15. And the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood.
Lies. Go ahead.
After the woman.
After the woman. Come on.
That he might cause
that
her.
That he might cause her.
To be carried away of the flood.
So that being that didn't work, then comes the physical. That's the point.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Back to 2nd Ezra.
2nd Ezra.
16 and 70.
Chapter 16 and verse 70. For there shall be in every place and in the next cities a great insurrection upon those that fear the Lord.
So we got to get our minds right and prepare our souls. Go ahead.
They shall be like madmen.
The Esau and his nation shall be like madmen. Go ahead.
Sparing none.
They ain't going to spare the Israelites. Go ahead.
But still spoiling and destroying those that fear the Lord.
Anybody that holds true to this Bible, the Israelites that keep the commandments in the faith of Christ, they're going to destroy us. Go ahead.
For they shall waste and take away their goods.
See that? They're going to waste and take away their goods. Go ahead.
And cast them out of their houses.
And cast them out of their houses. Go ahead.
Then shall they be known who are my chosen. And they shall be tried as the gold in the fire.
That's the real what 2nd Ezra 2 is going into. That's the ultimate. Because we read 2nd Ezra 2 and we just keep it at bills. Oh, I couldn't pay my bills. I'm like gold tried in the furnace. No, that ain't the fulfillment. The fulfillment is this right here. Read that again, verse 73.
Then shall they be known who are my chosen, and they shall be tried as the gold in the fire.
What is the trying talking about? Read 70 and 71 again.
For there shall be in every place and in the next cities a great insurrection upon those that fear the Lord. They shall be like madmen, sparing none, but still spoiling and destroying those that fear the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
For they shall waste and take away their goods and cast them out of their houses. Then shall they be known who are my chosen, and they shall be tried as the gold in the fire.
Now look at 2 Ezra 2 and 5, because we always read this. 2 Ezra 2 and 5. Is that it? No, Sirach, Ecclesiasticus, I'm sorry. Ecclesiasticus 2 and 5.
The book of Sirach. The book of Sirach, chapter 2 and verse 5. For gold is tried in the fire, and acceptable men in the furnace of adversity. Verse 1, my son, if thou come to serve the Lord, prepare thy soul for temptations.
So the temptation, the first thought is, oh, I'm being tempted by a woman that's not my wife. I'm being tempted by a man that's not my husband. That's the first thought we got. Go ahead.
Set thy heart aright and constantly endure and make not haste in the time of trouble.
So the time of trouble, oh, you can't pay your bills. That's the first thought. Go ahead.
Cleave unto him and depart not away, that thou mayest be increased at thy last end.
Mm-hmm.
Whatsoever is brought upon thee, take cheerfully.
Now that whatsoever covers a whole lot of stuff, including what we just read in 2nd Ezra 16. Go ahead.
And be patient when thou art changed to a low estate.
Now that low estate, we say, oh, you lost your job. Let's look at 2nd Ezra 16. We're coming back. 2nd Ezra 16, 72.
The book of 2nd Ezra, chapter
6. Here's the low estate.
16 and verse 72. For they shall waste and take away their goods and cast them out of their houses.
Now go back to Ecclesiastes 2 and verse 4.
Sirach chapter 2 and verse 4. Whatsoever is brought upon thee, take cheerfully and be patient when thou art changed to a low estate.
Read.
For gold is tried in the fire and acceptable men in the furnace of adversity.
Now we know, go back to 73. 2nd Ezra 16, 73.
2nd Ezra, chapter 16 and verse 73. Then shall they be known who are my chosen, and they shall be tried as the gold in the fire.
So now we see how far Sirach 2, one down, goes to. It's more. I'm not saying you can't talk about bills, and you could throw that in there, but it's really going into the tribulation that's going to come upon us in the last days. Everybody see that? Sure. Read on.
Hear, O ye my beloved, saith the Lord. Behold, the days of trouble are at hand.
You see that? The days of trouble, that's tribulation, are at hand. Go ahead.
But I will deliver you from the same.
He promised to deliver us. If we keep God's commandments, like it says, read 67 again.
67. Behold, God himself is the judge. Fear him. Leave off from your sins and forget your iniquities to meddle no more with them forever.
And what will he do?
So shall God lead you forth and deliver you from all trouble.
Now verse 74.
Hear, O ye my beloved, saith the Lord. Behold, the days of trouble are at hand, but I will deliver you from the same.
That's only for those men and women that meddle no more in their iniquities. I hope everybody understand that. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Be ye not afraid, neither doubt, for God is your guide.
Be not afraid, neither doubt. Go ahead.
For God is your guide.
God is your guide. Go ahead.
And the guide of them who keep my commandments.
See that? He's the guide of them that keep his commandments.
And precepts.
And precepts.
Saith the Lord God.
Here comes.
Let not your sins weigh you down.
So we all sin. But he says, don't let your sins weigh you down. Once you repent of it, let it go. Don't let it linger in your mind and your thoughts. And you go, then all of a sudden, because you're going to go right back to it. Go ahead, read it again.
And the guide of them who keep my commandments and precepts, saith the Lord, let not your sins weigh you down, and let not your iniquities lift up themselves.
Because if you let them weigh you down, it's going to rise up in you again. That's what he's saying. Your iniquities will start to rise up, meaning what? You'll start to meddle with them again. Oh, look, breast. Tetas. Oh, look, look, I just press a button. Oh, look, pretty 16-year-old. Boop! Underage, nigga, underage. The hell is wrong with you? Go ahead.
Woe be unto them that are bound with their sins.
And woe be unto them that are bound with their sins. If you can't get out of that, there's no counsel that works for you. There's no fasting that works for you. The Bible says, woe be unto them that are bound with their sins. Right. You're entangled. You're totally entangled. Go ahead.
Woe be unto them that are bound with their sins and covered with their iniquities.
You're covered with your sins. So, hey, some sisters we have come across in IUIC are pathological adulteresses or fornicators. She can't stop sucking somebody else's, what you call it. She, from Monday to Friday, she go from this brother to that brother to that brother. We've had at least two cases like that so far that I can remember. Two cases. Just go from, no, three. I'm sorry, three. I just thought of the third one. Nope, four. I'm sorry, four. Four women that I can think of right now. I ain't gonna call their name out. But, you know, for every whorish woman, there's a whorish man. You knew she was just with this brother over here. And now here you go. Now you want to get with her. What kind of nasty, scallywag, skanky stuff is going on in here?
The hell is this?
This sounds like some of these other camps. That's why they just got to go. Read it again.
Woe be unto them that are bound with their sins and covered with their iniquities. Like as a field is covered over with bushes and the path thereof covered with thorns.
Excuse me. I'm sorry. We ever walk down the street and there's bushes and weeds all over the pathway. You can't even get through it. You got to set fire to that thing. Read it again.
Woe be unto them that are bound with their sins and covered with their iniquities, like as a field is covered over with bushes, and the path thereof covered with thorns, that no man may travel through.
No man can travel through. Nobody can help you. Nobody can get through to you. When we think we're talking to you, we're not talking to you. We're talking to the adulterer. We're talking to the liar. We are talking to the thief. That ain't the real. We're trying to, hey, can we get through all of this? It's hard.
Think about the actual analogy of somebody literally covered with thorns and you're trying to physically reach in there to get them.
You're going to get pricked. You're not going to, you're never going to be able to reach them. That's how the sin's got some people bound. And they'll be justifying what they're doing. You read the scriptures to them and they still talk about some, no, but. That's them covering themselves with thorns. You're trying to reach it, you're trying to reach them with the Bible and they're not hearing it.
Exactly. Isaiah 11 and 10. We're almost done. We're almost done. Isaiah 11 and 10.
The book of Isaiah.
Did I say we're almost done before? We're almost done. Okay, I'm sorry. This is it. Isaiah 11 and 10.
The book of Isaiah, chapter 11 and verse 10. And in that day, there shall be a root of Jesse, which shall stand for an ensign of the people.
So this ensign is Christ. He stands for an ensign of the people. But guess what? Christ on the earth today is really going into the word of God being taught through his sons, his prophets. Everybody understand that?
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
To it shall the Gentiles seek.
And we're going to find out who these Gentiles are. Go ahead.
And his rest shall be glorious.
Read.
And it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall set his hand again the second time to recover the remnant of his people.
That's who the Gentiles are, to recover the remnant of his people.
Which shall be left from Assyria.
Assyria, that's going into Turkey. Go ahead.
And from Egypt.
Egypt, go ahead.
And from Patros.
Write this down, Sudan. That's Sudan. Go ahead.
And from Cush.
And from Cush, Ethiopia.
And from Elam.
Elam, that's Iran and India. Go
and ahead. From Shinar.
Shinar is Iraq.
And from Hamath.
That's Syria. Hamath is Syria.
And from the islands of the sea.
You got Cape Verde, you got the Hawaiian Islands, you got Puerto Rico, you got Papua New Guinea. There's many islands that our people are scattered on. Go ahead.
And he shall set up an ensign for the nation.
Did I go too fast? No? Okay, go ahead.
And he shall set up an ensign for the nation.
That's the Bible, the word of God being taught through his prophets. Go ahead.
And shall assemble the outcasts of Israel.
So the Gentiles that we read about in verse 10 that he's going to seek for are the outcasts of Israel, his people. Go ahead.
And gather together the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth.
That, again, is the Gentiles that he's seeking for. Go ahead.
The envy also of Ephraim shall depart.
So amongst the 12 tribes, the Lord says the envy, which is hatred, also of Ephraim, northern kingdom, has to stop their hatred for southern kingdom. Read it again.
The envy also of Ephraim shall depart.
If Ephraim wants to be saved, northern kingdom wants to be saved, that hatred must depart. Go ahead.
And the adversaries of Judah shall be cut off.
And the enemies of Judah shall be cut off. Go ahead.
Ephraim shall not envy Judah.
Ephraim shall not envy Judah, shall not hate Judah.
And Judah shall not vex Ephraim.
And Judah shall not hate Ephraim. That's love thy neighbor as you love yourself. Everybody understand that?
Yes, sir.
That love must go throughout the 12 tribes of Israel. Go ahead.
But they shall fly upon the shoulders of the Philistines.
When it says we shall fly upon the shoulders of the Philistines, that's the Palestinians. When we to fly upon their shoulders means we're going to bring them down. We're going to topple them. We're going to overcome them. Read it again.
But they shall fly upon the shoulders of the Philistines toward the west.
Uh-huh.
They shall spoil them of the east together.
We're going to spoil them of the west and the east. We're going to consume all nations. That's what he's saying. Go ahead.
They shall lay their hand upon Edom and Moab.
We're going to lay our hands upon Edom, the so-called white man, and Moab, the so-called Chinese. Go ahead.
And the children of Ammon.
And the children of these damn Japanese.
Shall obey them.
They're going to obey us. Everybody understand that?
Yes, sir.
12 tribes.
Worldwide.
12 tribes.
Worldwide.
12 tribes.
Worldwide.
And with that, we say shalom.
All praise, all praise.
I hope y'all took good notes.
All praises to the Most High. Check, 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 mic check. All praises to the Most High. Y'all give Bishop another round of applause, man.
Hey, bro.
Another fire class. Check, check. Another fire class. I hope y'all brothers took notes.
And to the brothers that don't study, I know that was very painstaking for you. Hopefully that will influence you to study and take good notes. So we got the Holy Spirit in here today. We got the bishops. We got the deacons. All praises to the Most High. Deeks, y'all want to say something?
Deacon Malachi.
Yo, hey, first time I'm here in Dallas, man. I want to shout out all of you brothers for the hospitality. Okay, shout out to all you brothers and sisters for the hospitality, man. You know, first time I'm coming out here in Dallas. I said, let me come and vibe some brothers and sisters out here and see what's up. You know, and I see y'all growing. It's a good spread. I like the school, man. It's nice, you understand? It's nice. I don't really mess with Texas like that, but you know. Y'all always hear me say that. I ain't like Texas, man. You know, this land belonged to my brothers. And, you know, just driving around, and I'm like, yo, today brother driving me around, I said, this land belongs to Issachar. This land belongs to Mexico. You know what I mean? That's all running through my mind, yo. You understand? They stole it. You understand? Don't get me wrong. They stole the whole Americas, but I just, you understand? You know? And you brothers, you Northern Kingdom brothers, you brothers, rise up, man, and do what Christ called you all to do. You hear that scripture we just read, that last scripture? Okay? Let's rise up and let's do what we got to do, what Christ called us to do. You brothers, build yourself up. You Dallas brothers, make sure you all study, man. Make sure you all know the scriptures because, yo, Isaac, we're going to stay messing with you, bro. These brothers got to warn it, bro.
That's
you understand?
Good. Yeah.
Make sure you all on point. Make sure you all know these scriptures. Okay, all of you brothers that all over the world, because you all ain't just come here to just sit on and learn. You all have to know everything that we know. You have to. You all understand? So, yo, big up, Dallas. You understand? You done know, Lord's will. I come visit again. You understand? Lord's will. You understand? Uh-huh. Big up New York, man. Big up New York. Big up Jersey. Big up Captain Zeph, Captain Young, you all done know. You know, I got a shout out New York. Okay, all right. Shout out the Tri-State area. Done with Atlanta, you know, thumbs down for Atlanta. Okay.
Hey, Bishop, last time you did this, Bishop, was it Ammon? Ammon got mad and came for our pages. Remember that?
Yeah.
We need all hands on deck. Y'all better protect your YouTube pages. I remember I got threats. They said, we gonna get you too, nigga. It's all right. Everything brought out today is biblical, so get mad at that. Notice, like Bishop was talking about the hate speech. Remember,
I see Deacon Isaac is doing his thing here with the captains, the officers. You guys doing a great job. A great job. Deacon Isaac, I think it's almost time for you to get out of here, bro. You got your go here. All praise to Mosai. I just want to say thank you for the hospitality to Dallas here. Thank you. I appreciate it, man. All right? Shout out to ATL. Shout out to ATL, Captain Shemaya, Hamazaya, AVA.
No, we're not going to promote that here. We ain't going to promote ATL here, bro. Yeah, man, shout out to Texas, man. Yeah, we see great things here, man. Great things.
Yes.
Yeah, Deacon Isaac, great things, man. Hopefully to the most. That's all I'm gonna say is just like to see a time like that, Bishop, great class, sir. But to be in a time like this, man, just to be in a president, these great men, that's all I ask the Lord for. And your guys as well, man. Keep on the good work.
All right, all praise. Let's go to IUIC Sacramento. IUIC Sacramento. All right.
Captain Zakai, IUIC Sacramento. We're here in beautiful downtown Oakland, California at the Black Joy Parade 2024.
And joy. There ain't no damn joy up in here, man. There's and none but folly going on in this place.
Yeah.
that video, man. You may shout out to Connecticut, definitely.
Hey, no. Hey, run what's that back, on? Man. It's some, like, there's some, like, mental retardation.
What the hell was that? Yo, pick up.
Hey, wait, hold on. There's some, hey, Deke, hold on. There's some, like, mental retardation going in there. I know there's a mixed multitude of people in there. You got Dallas, you got Austin. Come on, man. Get the shit together,
blame somebody,
man.
Isaac. Yeah, you need to blame somebody. Blame somebody, brother.
Hey, let's run that back. IUIC Sacramento at the Black Joy Parade. Let's play the full video. The full video.
Captain Zakai, IUIC Sacramento. We're here in beautiful downtown Oakland, yeah, California, you at the follow Black Joy Parade 2024.
And joy. There ain't no damn joy up in here, man. There's and none but folly going on in this place.
Sacramento and other mighty men of IUIC descended on Oakland last Sunday, igniting real joy at the 7th Annual Black Joy Parade with the spirit of the Most High. They held many camps and distributed thousands of flyers, unleashing a tidal wave of truth that surged through the streets. Mini doc coming soon. All right, let's go to New York.
Yeah, man, shout out to Oakland, man. That was a good hospitality there, too.
New York.
Hey, Shalom Israel, Most High and Christ blessed. I'm Officer Obadiah. Thank
you. Officer Tobias.
We are here to teach our people who they are according to the Bible.
Israel united in Christ, we are reaching out to the people in Albany to come back to your true heritage, your true nationality, and your true God.
I came from where it's drama and it's hostile. Where I'm at, we killed
from the tribe of Judah.
More than 12, it's like 1,000 apostles. Hit your block and then we dip like it's nachos. What's a op? We in the kitchen where they pop toast. Riding like a Tahoe, never scared of them potholes. We came to save the same ones they made a victim. Plague with the sick.
So fun for you to be part of any kind of organization that doing something positive, constructive, to try to get you young men and women back on track.
We met a lot of our people and, you know, a lot of opinions that they have. A lot of people learn a lot about their history. Still, we still got people learning right now. So all praises to the Most High. Albany, IUIC is here. Reach out to us. Come on home. Let's keep God's commandments and get out of this wicked kingdom.
All praise. The prophets touched down in Albany, New York for the 53rd Annual Legislative Conference, where we distributed many flyers and taught the word of God and shared Black and Hispanic history. Make sure you subscribe to all IUIC headquarter social media platforms. All right, let's go to Arkansas.
Black history is not just Harriet Tubman, Martin Luther King, Marcus Garvey. It's your forefathers. Rustin.
Hey, Shalom Israel, Most High Christ bless. It's Officer Baruch, IUIC Arkansas.
Officer Hezekiah.
Hey, all praise to the Most High. We had the opportunity to have a Black History Month presentation. We were able to sit down with the students and show the Black image of Christ. Joe, all praises. How did the students receive it?
Hey, surprisingly, the students, they received it very well. We had the boys basketball team and we had the girls basketball team. They were very receptive with the message.
Yes, sir. All praise to the Most High. We got another opportunity to sit down with them. So y'all stay tuned. Shalom. Most High Christ bless.
Shalom.
All praise. The prophets of IUIC Arkansas hit a college campus for a Black History Month presentation. All praise to the Most High. The students were edified about their history, and the Most High got the victory. Let's head to Tulsa, Oklahoma.
Oklahoma.
Hey, Shalom Osiris,
Lord.
Press play, press play. Christ, blessed is Officer Chef with IUIC Tulsa. We have just completed our first Youth Violence Conflict Resolution Seminar. It was a good success. We had some guest speakers. This is definitely going to be the first of many. We were able to reach the youth and let them know and give them solutions in the Bible to help them deal with the things that are going on in a day-to-day basis. Like I said, we had some guest speakers. One of them was one of the lead detectives off of the first 48. He was able to give some insights, a lot of the crime and the murders that happened here in Tulsa, and even give our children some of those images and see. Because a lot of times our children, they think murder is cool, but they don't see those images. They don't see the devastated families. So now this is our job. We are here to show our young people that we are their role models. We are the gods. We are the ones to look up to. We're going to be in your communities, and we're going to make the difference. All right? Shalom.
All right. As Officer Self stated, this was IUIC Tulsa's first Youth Violence Conflict Resolution Seminar. All praise to the Most High. To see the full seminar, subscribe to IUIC Tulsa on YouTube. Next one. Let's go to Detroit. Detroit, Michigan. Let's go to Detroit. All right.
11-year-old girl shot and killed while attending sleepover in Detroit. When we read about issues like this, when we read about the young girl getting murdered in the drive-by, killed by her own people, you gotta look and see, why is this happening to us?
Where are the leaders at? Where are the black leaders at showing our people the way, giving our people a better example? We don't have any. There's no leaders out here now.
Hear the word of the Lord, ye children of Israel. Mm. For the Lord hath a controversy with the inhabitants of the land.
God got a controversy with the Israelites. Why? Because we became a sinful people.
By swearing and lying.
By swearing, lying, come on.
And killing.
And doing what?
And killing.
And killing each other.
They break out and blood toucheth blood.
Black on black crime. What are we reading? The Bible. Mm. Showing you what happens to us when we go away from God's commandments.
For among my people are found wicked men.
Wicked men. Why are all these men wicked? Because they are lacking God's law. It's the time that you be a man and rise up for your people. Seriously, you cannot be a real man without keeping God's laws.
All right, all praise to the Most High. The captains of IUIC, Blaze Power 88.1 FM radio in Detroit, Michigan. All praise to the Most High. Let's go to the destruction of Nicanor. Pull it up on the screen. All right, March 7th. March 7th, which is Wednesday at sundown, we will celebrate the feast in all of our schools and local.